It dies, a curse, or is it something worse? Baseball legend has it that Boston is cursed by the Vampiro, as witnessed 20 years ago yesterday on a cool October day.
Deep the left. Yastrzemski will not get his home run.
But Boston believes in the here and now, and what's past is past. In Game 1, the pitching of Pedro powered the Red Sox to a 1-0 series lead over Cleveland. Then in Game 2, the doctor left the house suddenly, and fate finally seemed to be on Boston's side. But the defending American League champions would not say die, as the tribe said, yo, mo, this series is even steeper. Yesterday in Game 3, Boston found itself back in front of a friendly monster. And who else could script a better comeback story than gutsy Fred Saberhagen? Saberhagen rolled through 5 until Tony answered with a long drive. Charles was in charge when Manny added 2 more to settle Game 3's score. Will the Sox end 80 cursed years and fight off the postseason tears? Who you gonna call for some long ball? Nomar and Moe, and they're ready to bust up those ghosts. It's Cleveland and Boston in Game 4 of the American League Division Series, next on Fox.
Fenway Park is buzzing with both excitement and anxiety. Those Boston fans know about the anxiety part. The faithful getting ready with scorebooks and pencils in hand. And those famous sweet Boston sausages will be a-cooking today. The turnstiles will be cranking for a packed ballpark for AL Division Series Game 4 between the Indians and the Red Sox. A couple of mighty left-hand swinging first basemen will do battle. Mo Vaughn of the Red Sox has been awesome. Jim Thome and the Indians have been terrific, too. As on the field, it's all business for Game 4 from Fenway. Welcome to the Fox Network Center. The Yankees have already advanced to the ALCS, and they await the winner from our game today between the Indians and the Boston Red Sox. Hi again, everybody. I'm Chip Carey, along with my cohort, Steve Psycho Lyons. Steve, before we talk about today's exciting game from Fenway Park, the story around baseball, of course, the condition of Daryl Strawberry undergoing surgery for cancer in New York.
Well, Chip, I don't think anybody in the TV business was harder on Daryl Strawberry or the Yankees than I was. I blasted the Yankee organization when they re-signed Daryl a couple years ago. I said that I thought he had abused his chances to play the game of baseball. He abused the talent that he had, and he didn't respect the game enough to deserve another chance. But I'll tell you what, I saw Daryl Strawberry change his life around both on and off the field. He was having his best year since 1991. And I'll tell you what, nobody wishes cancer on anyone like this. It's a terrible situation.
But everybody wishes a speedy recovery for Daryl Strawberry, who yesterday was talking outside his Fort Lee, New Jersey home about the surgery today. And he also wanted to let his teammates and fans know how he was feeling at this very emotional time in his life.
Not that I'm afraid or anything. It's just... worked so hard to, you know, get back to playing baseball and being a part of this Yankee ball club. But then you reach this point where you get to the playoffs, you're not able to be a part of it because of a illness in it that, like I said, I really have no control over, and all I can do is try to be strong and do the best that I can.
Now, Fox Sports News' Sam Marciano standing by live from New York's Columbia Presbyterian Hospital with an update on the Yankee slugger's surgery. Sam, good afternoon. What can you tell us about the latest?
Well, it's been a very anxious day of waiting here at the hospital. Surgery began just after 1 o'clock Eastern time. Daryl Strawberry is still in surgery as of 4 p.m., that according to a hospital administrator. And this is very normal. This type of surgery does take about 2 to 6 hours generally. And what doctors say is probably happening is not only are they removing the tumor, but they're also looking to see if the cancer has spread.
And, of course, the Yankees clinched in Texas last night. Have any of the Yankees shown up at the hospital to try to support Strawberry and his family today?
Not yet. The Yankees aren't in New York yet. They're due here within the hour, and it's quite possible that we'll see some of them either later on this evening or tomorrow.
Sam, how ironic is it that Daryl Strawberry is going through the same situation that one of his boyhood friends did, Eric Davis, last year? Eric, of course, conquered his cancer problem.
It's ironic, and it could be life-saving in this situation because it was Eric Davis who suggests that Daryl go to the doctor and get it checked out, so it could be something that actually saved Daryl's life.
Sam, thank you very much for that report from New York. We appreciate your good work, and we'll keep all our fans updated on news concerning Daryl Strawberry as his condition is evaluated later on today. Thank you once again, Sam Marciano. Now, Daryl's teammates dedicated last night's game to their ailing teammate, and they wanted a clinch, Their spot of the ALCS last night for him down in Texas. All the Yankees wore Darryl's number 39 on the back of those Yankee caps. And how about this young man, Shane Spencer? He has been unbelievable.
That's not his name. His name is Roy Hobbs. He's a natural. He's got 9 home runs in his last 33 at-bats. And 15 minutes later, the rain came. It was lightning. It was storming. He is the natural.
But he doesn't play for the New York Knights. He plays for the New York Yankees, who shut out Texas last night, 4-0, a 3-game sweep of the AL Divisional Series. On to the AL Championship Series go the New York Yankees once again to await either the Red Sox or the Indians. The celebration in the Yankee clubhouse was excited, somewhat subdued. They know they still have work left to be done if they are to have a successful season. Only a world championship will do in New York. But the story of this series, Texas's offense completely shut down by the Yankees pitching staff.
Yeah, I can guarantee you there's no smiles on any of those guys' faces today. They went 4 for 44. 3 of the 4 of those guys drove in 100 runs during the season. I'll tell you what, they shut down Juan Gonzalez. He was just 1 for 12. And as poorly as that offensive performed, you got to give a lot of credit to the Yankee pitching staff. They dominated. That team scored 1 run in 3 games.
So here's the question. The Yankees 7-5 against Boston, 7-4 against Cleveland this year. Who do these guys want to play in the next round?
You know, you're going to get your stock answer. Yes, the Yankees are going to say, oh, we don't care who we play, whoever it is. You know what? They want to face the Cleveland Indians. I think they match up better against those guys. And they remember last year when they were heavily favored against the Indians in the playoffs, and the Indians came in and knocked them out. They want revenge for that series.
Well, the Yankees are in their second ALCS in 3 years, and they'll play the Indians and the Red Sox. Winner Joe Buck, Tim McCarver are standing by from Fenway Park with insight on what has been an explosive series so far. All right, Chip, while we sun ourselves here in the bullpen at Fenway Park, we talk about the great debate around here. Obvious what is in line and at stake here this afternoon. The Cleveland Indians trying to win today to get back to the ALCS to take on the Yankees this year. The Boston Red Sox trying to win today to get this series back to Cleveland tomorrow. And the question around here, who pitches, who starts? Is it Pete or Pete? The answer is Pete Schourek, not Pete Martinez. Pedro will not pitch on 3 days rest.
And if this were 25 years ago, there would be no controversy, because 25 years ago, there were four-man rotations and guys were used to pitching on 3 days rest. Pedro Martinez has worked on 3 days rest only once during his career, and Jimmy Williams has a good point. He says, we've got to win 2 games, so why not pitch guys in their set rotation? Pitch Pete Schourek today with 4 days rest and Pete Martinez tomorrow with 4 days rest.
One other point. It is a sunny day here in Fenway today. It has been difficult for hitters to hit here at Fenway in the late afternoon with the shadows. They hope to get Schourek through 5, maybe 6 innings, depending on how many pitches he has thrown. That means they'll go to the bullpen early. These bullpens will be active today here at Fenway. A lot on the line for these two teams. Hope you join us in just a moment. For Tim, I'm Joe. Let's go back to Los Angeles to check in with Chip Garrett. Okay, Joe, thanks a lot. Could be a happy birthday for one of those Red Sox pen men, Dennis Eckersley, 44 years old today. But if Boston's going to win this series, not only do they have to pitch, but somebody other than Mo Vaughn and Nomar Garciaparra are going to have to start hitting.
The rest of this team has just absolutely gone away. Nomar and Mo Vaughn have done it all for them. They have all but one RBI in the entire series, 17 of them between Garciaparra and Vaughn. Now, we said that if you shut these guys down, you have a chance to win. But if they're the only guys that do something for that team, you're still going to have an excellent chance of winning. This team around those two players is doing absolutely nothing. They're going to have to step it up.
Who would you have pitched today?
You know, I'll tell you what, I got to go with the guy that you're paying $12 million to, Pedro Martinez. Even though he only goes 170 pounds, a lot of people mistake him for the bat boy when he shows up at a ballpark. He's your ace, and I think you're wrong. You don't have 2 wins that you have to get. You got to win this one in order to get to the next win. You go with your best pitcher.
Well, we'll see if Boston can do that with Pete Schourek on the mound today in the shadows at Fenway Park. Well, the playoffs are on the front pages. Baseball's behind-the-scenes stories are always developing. Time to get you caught up with those on our Fox Insider. Roberto Alomar, we understand, will not play for the Baltimore Orioles again. And Fox sources say that following the team's final series in Boston, Alomar didn't even travel back to Baltimore with the team. Alomar's locker's been completely cleaned out and even his nameplate removed from the clubhouse. The team that expects to land the perennial Gold Glover is the Cleveland Indians, where he could join his brother Sandy and fill a big hole for Cleveland at second base. Sources also say the Indians will do everything they can to sign either Astro ace Randy Johnson or Padre power pitcher Kevin Brown. Fox Insider sources also confirm the Orioles will throw big bucks Kevin Brown's way, and New York's Mets lefty Al Leiter, also a prime Oriole target. And finally, Leiter's battery mate Mike Piazza is also a top, if not the top, offseason prize on the market. Our sources confirm that Colorado will offer Piazza a 3-year, $40 million deal but will not give Piazza the five-year deal that he wants so desperately to sign. How about Robbie Alomar? Surprised he's heading out of Baltimore this way?
Not really, but, you know, when you clean out your locker before the season's even over, that's a pretty good sign that you're not coming back. And as far as all those free agents, it's sort of like your money. Those guys just get to flip a coin, decide where they want to play, because they're going to get their pay no matter where they play.
The only guy that laughs at money on this set is you, my friend. All right, when we come back, we'll take a look at the continuing explosives in the AL Division Series. Manny Ramirez and his Indians are one game away from knocking off the Sox, and Steve's psychoanalyses will focus on the wild series in the National League between the Astros and the San Diego Padres. Also, in Chicago today, the Cubs are desperate for a win. They suffered a heartbreaking loss in Game 2 down in Atlanta, where the Braves are again feeling very chipper. Bartolo Colon and Pete Schourek getting ready for a battle in Beantown. We'll have more right after this.
I don't want to pull over.
Hey, you guys. Hey, you guys, here. The air is on.
Right.
Roll down your window.
No, roll up your window.
Introducing Solara. An entirely different kind of Camry. It's for you. In the financial world, to survive, you must keep on the move. It is not a world for the hesitant or the timid. Sometimes, to defend against larger, fiercer competitors, your best choice is merger or acquisition. But beware, lest your careful, well-planned strategy should result instead in failure or doom. In these troubled waters, experience, knowledge, and size are your best allies. If you're considering strengthening your company through merger or acquisition, think first of First Union. Wherever you plan to go, we have been there before. Come to the mountain called First Union. Or if you prefer, the mountain will come to you.
I believe I can call.
I think I'll use the phone in the hall.
I call my swing just to take
with 5 cents Monday from MCI.
My Space Jam buddies and I stay in close touch with MCI's 5 cents Sunday.
Just 5 cents a minute.
Every minute. Every Sunday.
Along with low weights. Low rates all week long. Call 1-800-SUNDAY to become an MCI customer.
I believe I can call.
On Fox NFL Sunday, Dion and the boys battle the Skins. Then the Eagles take on the Broncos. It's a Fox NFL Sunday doubleheader tomorrow.
Hey, Billy. Where's the sight of all of that?
We were just saying it's inside.
You know, a couple of other guys say... I know a couple of other guys saying on the other side of the plate. You know, Tom gets them out there.
I'm not going to stand here and, you know,
all right. I'm not arguing balls, but I'm just telling you. You know, I can't tell from where I'm at. I can't see in and out, but I know what my guys say.
You always wonder what the manager and the umpire talk about when they come out to make their points. Jim Riggeman and Bill Hahn both able to make their points without crossing the line in that critical game, too, of the National League Division Series between the Cubs and the Braves. Welcome back to the Fox Network Center. And friends, this is a scary thought. Steve Lyons stayed up all night last night putting together his psychoanalysis piece focusing on the two NLDSs.
You know, I stay up a lot of nights lately thinking about this National League Series, and it's been a great one. Let's start with the Cubs series. Go to the tape and check out. They're shutting down Sammy Sosa. You know, a lot of people forget that Sammy Sosa was a 30-30 guy. Here he is trying to get something going for the Cubs by trying to steal some bases. Javi Lopez behind a dish for the Braves, gunning him down, not once, but twice. Sammy's doing anything he can do to get the Cubs offense going. Unfortunately, at the plate, he's been silenced too. Just 2-for-7 in the series, no home run. Now, what are the Braves going to do for their closer? They have a lot of options. John Rocker, this guy, nasty from the left-hand side. He can come out there. Rudy Fiennes, another youngster, he can come out and get it done. The guy they have been using, Terry Leitenberg with the bad sideburns, been very wild, walked 4 guys already. Not the closer that he's been all year long. He's had 30 saves. And then who's this guy? Oh, Dallas Perez pitching in the 10th inning. Bobby Cox has a lot of confidence in any one of those guys to get the job done. How about the Braves in crunch time? Javi Lopez, this is as close as you'll ever get to a home run swing right there, Chip. Coming through in the clutch, Chipper Jones, he had struck out three times in this game before. He comes up with a big double to win the game here for the Braves. It just seems like yesterday, those two guys, Lopez and Jones, were youngsters, not anymore, big-time players. Let's go over to the Astros series. The killer bees. They're 5-for-58 in postseason play, but they're starting to get it done. Biggio with the glove, Bell with his first ever postseason hit. It's a big home run, and the guy that you expect to produce, Jeff Bagwell, came up with three RBIs, a couple of them right here on this base hit up the middle. In game two for the Astros, they are starting to play like they're supposed to play. For the Padres, a different hero every day, Jimmy Leyritz. This is a tough pitch. Off of Billy Wagner, a 99-mile-an-hour fastball. He goes the opposite direction for the home run to tie the game. But the Astros have those unsung heroes of their own. Billy Spires at third base, both defensively and offensively, come through with a big game-winning hit. They also have Kenny Bogaerts and Eusebio on the bench. Those guys are the bench jockeys. They can get it done if they have to come in. Now, for both of these teams, who's the closer? Billy Wagner having some trouble. He gave up the big home run to Leyritz. He's saved 30 of 35 games during the season, but you got to shut the door down when you're called on if they're going to do it. Also, Trevor Hoffman for the Padres. They figured out with that big leg kick that they can steal on him if they get guys on base. That's the tough part. Hoffman didn't look good in game one. He gives up the game winner to Billy Spires in game two. And you know, Chip, how I hate the save situation. It's the most overrated stat in the game. Throw a guy out there, get three outs when you're supposed to do the job. But as we talked about before, Kevin Brown, that situation, I would have gone with Kevin Brown. We've seen that both closers have struggled in this series.
So two very different series, but they both focus around the same thing, rest. Maybe too much for Kerry Wood, who has to pitch in a must-winner for the Cubs. Maybe too little for Kevin Brown for the Padres, who goes in game three.
Kerry Wood says that he can go out and get the job done. Here's Kevin Brown right here. Here's a guy, he doesn't care how many days rest he's pitched. He's a gamer, and when he's a sinker ball pitcher, he wants to be tired because the ball gets more movement down in the zone. If he has too much rest, that sinker straightens out and gets up in the zone. He'll pitch on one day's rest if you'll let him.
And remember, when he struck out 16, he was doing that on 3 days rest. He pitched in a tune-up in the regular season, so look for Kevin Brown to have a very strong game number three for San Diego. Well, friends, we're getting set for game four between the Tribe and the Red Sox, and Boston fans, as they usually do this time of year, are screaming. They're screaming this time for Pedro, but Jimmy Williams is sticking to his guns. He's going to start left-hander Pete Schourek today.
He kept us in a lot of games, four or five games in a row there, where he was very pitch efficient and changed speeds and used both sides of the plate and went strike one a lot. So just the idea of watching him pitch and see how he pitched to me was very, very important as far as trying to win a game. And I think really feel this kid can really help us win a game by starting. I really do.
Tremendous confidence, to pass up a guy like Pedro in any circumstances is a big lift for me. And I'm confident myself, and I'm going to go out there and do the best I can.
Great story in the Boston Globe today by the fine writer Dan Shaughnessy. There's an anagram. If you use Pete Schourek's name and rearrange the letters, it says, Ruth, keep score. You don't think they're paranoid in Boston?
They better hope Ruth isn't keeping score. You know, when Jimmy Williams took over the job as the manager of the Red Sox a couple years ago, everyone thought that tough press would bury this guy. But guess what? He's a principled guy. He's a baseball guy. He knows what he's doing. But I'll tell you what, I don't know if he's making the right decision. For $12 million, I send that guy, Pedro Martinez, the best pitcher they have, to the mound, because they don't have to win two games. They have to win one, and then they have to win another one. They don't win today, they're out.
But if they do win today, they're going to have him for game five, and Jimmy Williams and company will look like geniuses. Well, friends, we're minutes away from game four of the Indians and the Boston Red Sox. But with the sobering news of Darryl Strawberry's cancer, it helps put baseball into perspective. And yesterday, there was even more sad news in the baseball world.
Gene Autry, better known as the Singing Cowboy, was one of the most popular and accomplished entertainers this century. Autry was also a baseball fan and purchased the California Angels, an expansion team, in 1960. For 38 years, he was one of baseball's most popular owners among players and fans alike. Gene Autry, a genuine American hero, was 91.
You're watching the 1998 American League Division Series.
It is an American institution, but the Pops will always belong to Boston. And in a business where performance is everything, the Boston Pops Orchestra chooses American Airlines to take them to concert halls around the world. So whether your business is business or your business is music, American can help you conduct it in over 250 cities worldwide.
Outside, it's got more power than any SUV in its class. Inside, it's as quiet as the open plains. Introducing the all-new V6 Grand Vitara from Suzuki.
After Suzuki!
I hope she got my good side.
Oh, Peter Lynch. I'm Susie, your stress technician, trainee. Not to worry. Here we go. Wow. Under control.
This reminds me of the stock market.
It can't just shoot up without warning.
Sure can.
And then drop?
25% or more. Four times. 1970. You know, Fidelity can help you better prepare for the market's ups and downs.
For the free guide, investing in volatile markets, call 1-800-FIDELITY or visit Fidelity.com.
Well, you're stress-free.
Here's your chance to get happy. The new 99s are in at your New England Ford dealer. Right now is the time to smile with the new 1999 Ford Taurus wagon. Over $1,600 less than last year's model at $19,445. Ford Taurus with a 5-star safety rating, the government's highest, plus 35 standard safety features, room for eight, plenty of cargo space, and now over $1,600 less than last year.
Oh, how happy you have made me.
The 99 Ford Taurus, built to last. Get happy at your New England Ford dealer.
It's the Sox on Fox 25 live from Fenway, today after the game.
Welcome to Boston, Massachusetts, and welcome to Game 4 of this division series between the Cleveland Indians and the Boston Red Sox. Fans filing through the gates here at Fenway, hoping they will see a Red Sox victory here at home in the postseason for the first time since the 1986 World Series. And welcome to the broadcast booth, everybody. I'm Joe Buck, along with my partner, Tim McCarver. Now, Tim, just like we talked about moments ago in the pregame show, the big story around here, who's going to pitch, Pedro Martinez or Pete Schourek? But maybe a bigger question, who's going to help? Who's going to help Mo Vaughn and Nomar Garciaparra in this Red Sox lineup?
Who's going to drive in some runs? Because only two guys have supplied Boston pop in this three games thus far. Mo Vaughn, Nomar Garciaparra. Garciaparra has 10 RBIs, Mo Vaughn with 7, the rest of the team with 1. As a matter of fact, spots 5 through 9 in the order have 1 extra base hit. So Mo and Nomar need some help.
Meanwhile, a lot of help for Mike Cargrove's Cleveland Indians. In fact, the middle of their lineup is very deep and very solid, and in this series, they've been very productive.
I think the Cleveland Indians, the case could be made about their balance. Manny Ramirez with a couple of solo home runs in yesterday's game. Kenny Lofton had a solo home run. And the one guy you don't see in there is Jim Thome. So there's much better balance in the Cleveland Indians lineup.
For the Indians, young 23-year-old right-hander Bartolo Colon will be on the mound trying to get the Indians back to the ALCS to take on the Yankees. Meanwhile, Pete Schourek, not Pete Martinez, will pitch for Boston, trying to force this game back to Cleveland. We'll come back with the first pitch, the starting lineup, everything for you. Remember, Fox is your home for the 1998 World Series.
Gary, what Nintendo sports game would you like to play today?
There's Kobe Bryant and NBA wiping the floor with Gary courtside. Major League Gary bashing
with Ken Griffey Jr.
NHL Gary's going down on ice. WWF Gary is the turnbuckle war zone.
What?
Nintendo sports. What friends are for.
What?
Due to circumstances beyond our control, tonight's game is canceled.
Take your skates off, eh?
So what's up, Coach?
The game's postponed.
What?
What do you mean?
Some guy came in with a Wendy's spicy chicken sandwich.
Oh, they're good.
It was so hot, the ice melted.
Again?
Oh, for the love of Pete.
Wendy's spicy chicken is a whole breast fillet seasoned with Dave's own blend of pepper and spices. It's one hot sandwich.
That's the second time this week, Dave. Sorry.
Wendy's spicy chicken, when you're hot, you're hot.
It's amazing, but I feel like I'm finally free. Like I'm flying. It's like I'm king of the world.
Steve, you got a great deal on the fog lights. We're all very proud.
Nothing feels better than going to Pep Boys for accessories. We've got everything from floor mats to stereos, and our prices are always liberating.
Get your head in the car.
Pep Boys.
Cars like us. People love us.
The American League Division Series on Fox is brought to you by Visa. It's everywhere you want to be. By Wendy's Spicy Chicken Sandwich. When you're hot, you're hot. And by Nintendo Sports.
Well, welcome back to Fenway Park. It is October 3rd. It is October weather. And Tim, you and I were just talking before we came back from the commercial break. It's cool. There's a lot of anxiety in this ballpark. Fans wondering if the Boston Red Sox will force a Game 5 tomorrow night in Cleveland. It just feels like playoff baseball. It feels like fall now, and it feels like something big is about to unfold before us on a Saturday afternoon at Fenway.
It really does. The autumnal weather here as New England's trees are changing clothes, and what a great ballpark for postseason play, and the Red Sox hopeful that today's postseason game will be different from their last six. They have lost six straight postseason games in this park.
And fans around here wondering if maybe this is the last time they see Mo Vaughn in a Boston Red Sox uniform. This could conceivably be his final game in a Red Sox uniform and wearing the number 39 on the back of his hat. Today is the day for Daryl Strawberry in which he will undergo the operation to remove the cancerous portion of his colon, about a walnut-sized tumor. And, of course, all of baseball is thinking about Daryl Strawberry on this day. And, again, congratulations to the New York Yankees for getting back to the American League Championship Series. They did it with a 4-0 win last night in Arlington. A look at the starting lineup for the visiting Cleveland Indians. They lead it off with Kenny Lofton in center field. Omar Vizquel batting second at short. David Justice is in left field as he was here yesterday. And Manny Ramirez has really been pounding the ball in this series and has 11 postseason home runs. Number one, the Cleveland Indians franchise. Travis Fryman at third base. Jim Thome, the DH, with Sexton at first base. Sandy Alomar is the catcher. Enrique Wilson is batting ninth at second base. And you look at the Boston Red Sox defense. Darren Lewis, so good in center field. He has really made a difference in the lineup for Jimmy Williams. He's also had a good year at the plate. And it's Pete Schourek, the left-hander, on the mound. Not Pedro Martinez. They hope to have a chance to pitch him tomorrow night in Cleveland. And here's a look at the left-hander who started the year with Houston.
Talk about Darren Lewis in center field. Pete Schourek hoping to keep the ball in the ballpark for Darren Lewis and for all the outfielders, something the Red Sox pitchers were unable to do against Cleveland yesterday. Here's the scouting report on the Boston left-hander. He's recovering with his velocity. He had elbow surgery back in 1996. And he's developed a slider when he's ahead on an 0-2 count or a 1-2 count. They call it his check swing slider. His curveball is still effective, but his best pitch, his straight changeup. And that's it right there.
So Schourek, who was a late addition to this Boston Red Sox team, in fact acquired August 6th from Houston for cash, ends up pitching the game, which the Red Sox are facing elimination in this division series. You got a quick shot of Pedro Martinez, who has said today, he said yesterday, he said the day before, he was willing to pitch on 3 days rest, but he is an untested pitcher on 3 days rest. And Jimmy Williams has said, we're going to have to win two games to get to the next round anyway. And why force Martinez today? And look, nobody stands to benefit or gain more from the Red Sox advancing to the next round of the playoffs than Jimmy Williams. And nobody knows Pedro Martinez better than Jimmy Williams and maybe Joe Carrigan, who was with him in Montreal. If they don't think he can pitch today, to me, that's good enough. This broadcast is also available in Spanish by utilizing the SAP button on your television. Kenny Lofton will lead it off. He'll be followed by Omar Vizquel and David Justice. What I just said, however, about Pedro Martinez not pitching today is not the common feeling here in Boston. They want to see Pedro Martinez pitch today. And that is the debate raging on here in this area. All Red Sox fans saying, look, you got to get to game five anyway. Put him on the mound and take your chances tomorrow night. One ball, one strike on Kenny Lofton. Vizquel and Justice will follow here in the first inning for the Indians. And Lofton into left field. Left center field to be exact, and Darren Lewis is back to get it in front of that big green monster, one away.
Yeah, what Jimmy Williams told us before the game makes so much sense. He has to win two more games to go to the American League Championship Series. And why take two pitchers out of their rotation? Today, Pete Schourek is pitching with normal rest, and if the Red Sox win today, then Pedro Martinez will be pitching with his normal 4 days rest tomorrow night in Cleveland.
Here's Omar Vizquel, who is hitless in this division series. A strike over the outside corner from Pete Schourek. And again, Joe Carrigan was with Pedro Martinez, 26-year-old right-hander in Montreal. As Schourek brings it low and away, one ball, one strike. And Pedro Martinez has worked only once as a starter on 3 days rest, and today is not the day. Vizquel into left field, well hit. Back at the track is the left fielder O'Leary. A couple of steps in front of that big wall. Troy pulls it down for the second out here in the first inning.
I don't think either of those balls would have been up against the wall had the wind not been blowing, but the wind is blowing slightly, about 7 or 8 miles an hour, out toward right field. So it could affect the balls into left center and down the line in left field slightly.
David Justice now. A look at what he has done with a home run, an average of 250 in the 3 postseason games so far this year. And he bats with 2 out, nobody on here in the first. Ground ball to first for Vaughn. Makes a very good play, gets it out of his glove, and it's a very good first inning for Pete Schourek. The Indians go in order. The Red Sox come to bat. A big ovation for Schourek as the Red Sox hit the dugout.
If you thought AT&T One Way Plus made calling simple at 10 cents a minute,
a little too simple maybe.
Now there's something that'll have you calling even more.
What, are you sick?
Introducing 5 cents a minute on weekends.
That's half off.
AT&T One Rate Plus. 10 cents a minute, anytime, anywhere, and now 5 cents a minute on weekends.
How do you sleep at night? Some of you dialing perhaps a little too hard.
To get 5 cent weekends, call now to enroll.
I love lobster.
Boiled lobster.
Royal lobster.
Jumbo lobster.
Baked stuffed lobster.
Steamed lobster.
Lobster Newberg.
Lobster tail.
There he goes again.
Lobster roll. Sauteed lobster.
Did I mention lobster stew?
Boiled.
The Cook's Lobster House off the coast of Maine. They'll give you lobster just about any way you want it. But bring your Visa card, because you won't get a bite using American Express.
Sir, any suggestions?
There's boiled lobster.
Visa, it's everywhere you want to be.
People smile and tell me I'm the lucky one. And we've just begun. Think I'm gonna have some.
And in the morning when I rise, bring a tear of joy to my eyes and tell me everything's gonna be alright.
Insuring over 40 million people worldwide.
The American League Division Series on Fox is brought to you by Toyota. Get the most out of your day, every day.
First
first base is a left-handed thrower's position. Most of the throws go into the infield, but for the Red Sox, it's a good thing that Mo Vaughn has the glove on the left hand. Makes it easier for him on that in-between hop, the little shuffle off to Schourek to end the inning.
And a big ovation for the combination of Mo Vaughn and Pete Schourek as the two headed for the dugout. Schourek for getting through a perfect first inning. And Mo Vaughn, who is a fan favorite here in Boston. A look at the starting lineup for the Red Sox. Jimmy Williams leads it off with Darren Lewis in center. John Valentin bats second and third with Mo Vaughn hitting third and first base. Nomar Garciafara cleans up in short. Mike Stanley, the DH, with Troy O'Leary in left. Scott Hatteberg is the catcher, Mike Benjamin at second, and Darren Bragg is in right field batting ninth. The right-hander, Bartolo Colon, just 23 years old, possesses an above-average fastball and had a great first half of the 1998 season. Hits the outside corner with a fastball, strike one to Darren Lewis.
Bartolo Colon with the facial characteristics of Andres Galarraga, the first baseman of the Atlanta Braves.
That misses outside, one ball, one strike. You can't call it a collapse, but when you look at the season for Bartolo Colon as it started to wear on, he was an American League All-Star, was 9-4, with the best ERA in the league at 2.46 after the All-Star break, 5-5 with an ERA over 5.5. Strike two on Darren Lewis. Bartolo Colon also honoring Darryl Strawberry with a number 39. That's down the right field line, big. Played by Manny Ramirez. Going to have a play at second. Doubles. Ramirez puts it in his pocket. Darren Lewis has a leadoff double.
Just inside the line. Just inside the bag, and Manny Ramirez comes up with the ball cleanly, but I do not think he had a proper grip on the ball, and for that reason held on to it. Darren Lewis, almost like a left-handed four hitter, hits the ball to right with consistency. Doubles for the Red Sox to open it.
He ran right in the face of Manny Ramirez, who came up ready to throw, had a shot at him but pulled it back. And now Valentin digs in as the Red Sox try to take that early lead. Strike one. The numbers for Bartolo Colon. First full year in the big leagues, and it started to wear on him and his arm late. In fact, he skipped his spot in the rotation down the stretch. Colon trying to pitch around a leadoff double here in the first. One ball, one strike. Good numbers with the average for Valentin, but no production, no RBIs for the veteran third baseman. He's jammed, and that foul. Fryman over to give it a look, and it's two rows deep for strike two.
You're talking about Bartolo Colon and his tired legs or his tired arm. Mike Hargrove telling us before the game that it was one or the other. I mean, he pitched 204 innings this year. He's only 23 years old, and there are an awful lot of young pitchers who come up through the minor leagues, and they are never battle-tested for big league play. The most innings at Colon in 6 years in the minor leagues ever worked was 128 innings. And now to step into a role and work 204, it's understandable he has a tired arm or legs or whatever.
Here's the 1-2 to Valentin. Here's that mid-90s fastball up and away, 2-2. Detailed for you with a graphic, the good start. The poor second half for Colon. So you can wipe all of that away. First postseason start for the 23-year-old, and Valentin stays alive as the count stays 2-2.
There is nothing tired about the way he's delivering the ball tonight. He is blowing that fastball. What the Red Sox hitters will try to do, two things. try to sit on the fastball when they're behind in the count and try to make the fastball be down in the zone. The one upstairs explodes. Full count on Valentin. With the heat coming for the Red Sox, Vaughn and Garcia Parra to follow. Three balls, two strikes after a leadoff double by Darren Lewis. And Colon in first inning trouble. Double, a walk, and now trouble with Mo Vaughn digging in. This visit to the mound by Sandy Alomar Jr. only prolongs the ovation for Mo Vaughn, who is one of the fan favorites in the history of this great franchise here in Boston.
Coming into the divisional series 0-14, that happened back in 1995, and he erased that with an opposite field three-run homer against Jarrett Wright in game one.
He has two on with nobody out. The Red Sox facing elimination here in game four. Is out of play off to the left side for strike one.
That is why or where American League pitchers try to pitch Vaughn in under the hand, inside under the hand. However, don't get it down and in because that's his long ball. From mid thigh to the bottom of the letters and inside under the hand to Vaughn.
Vaughn broke his bat with that first strike, so he gets a new one and now works on it with pine tar and that stick as he walks back with a 0-1 count. Big numbers in the postseason for Vaughn. All of the RBIs coming in game one. Strike two.
Colon went outside to Vaughn, but you can't feed him a steady diet of balls outside. But once again, that is the zone where pitchers try to pitch him. That last one, a fastball on the outside corner.
Vaughn quickly in the hole, 0-2 with two on. Nobody out in the first inning for the Red Sox. 1-2. 98. Miles per hour from Bartolo Colon. Colon's going to have to come right after Mo Vaughn with Garcia Parra waiting on deck. Mike Hargrove did not know what he would get out of his 23-year-old right-hander. Not a good start. With a double, a walk, and now 2-2 on Vaughn. Strikeout for Colon. 98 miles per hour on a cold October day. Just too much heat for Mo Vaughn.
Give you an idea about what Colon is trying to do. Watch Sandy Alomar behind the plate. Fastball fouled off at inside. Fastball on the outside corner. Fastball inside misses, and now the breaking ball, a kneecap ball, and now he just blew that one by. That's how a guy like Colon
can get out of trouble. He can strike guys out. And that's what he did to Mo Vaughn.
Chance of MVP is Nomar Garciaparra digs in with two on, one out. A strike over the inside corner. According to the home plate umpire, Tim Tashita. Garciaparra, 10 RBIs in just three games in the postseason. One ball, one strike. Tashita behind the plate with Coble at first, Terry Kraft at second, Durwood Merrill at third, Jim Joyce and Richie Garcia are down the line. Darren Lewis can run. He's the lead runner at second with Valentin at first. And a one ball, one strike count on Garciaparra. Really have to look at today's game as their clear shot at getting to the next round. Not to say that they can't beat Pedro Martinez tomorrow night, but the odds against them certainly increase with the likes of Martinez on the mound. Colon trying to keep it a scoreless first inning. Two on, one out, two balls, a strike. Two and two.
The Indians, should they lose this afternoon, will go back in front of that great crowd of theirs at Jacobs Field, but they'll have to deal with Pedro, and that's never a pleasant task.
11-3 was the final in game one in that situation in Cleveland before that great crowd against Pedro Martinez, and Boston got game one. They've lost the next two as Garciaparra takes inside and the count runs full at 3-2.
I think Jimmy Williams sends his runners right here. If you're the catcher in a situation like that and speed is your front runner, you think about going to second base to get the trail runner in case the batter strikes out.
And a look back at second by Colon. Right watching from the Indians dugout as Colon brings it on 3-2. Runners go and Garciaparra grounds to short. The runners advance to second and third as Vizquel takes care of it to his right, two down. And by starting the runners, any hopes of a double play, although highly unlikely with the way Garciaparra runs, but by starting the runners, it ends up at least second and third instead of first and third with two out here in the first inning.
And a great job by Colon. First and second, nobody out. He's not out of the woods yet, but he has retired Vaughn and Garciaparra.
And now we'll work with Mike Stanley. Second and third with two down here in the first inning, and Stanley grounds it short. Vizquel to his left. Those are automatic. Bartolo Colon, a leadoff double, then a walk. Vaughn, Garciaparra, Stanley in order. Manny Ramirez will lead it off in the second. Here in Boston, no score.
The Amazon is the largest river in the world.
Toyota doesn't make parachutes. The 99 Corolla, grounded in reliability. And the 99 Corolla has double door seals to lock out those annoying road noises.
I have everything. dinosaur. I'm not 64 bits. And I don't play pro ball. What I am is a mentor. Not a psychologist, but I'm a listener. I don't have all the answers. I'm a mentor. I make a difference. This is my reward.
Kids who have mentors are less likely to do drugs. Be a mentor.
My dad always said,
as soon as I get a computer, you'll come out with something better.
So to make sure people like Dad have the latest computer, we invented YourWare, technology that grows with you. For just $49.95 a month, you can buy a computer with an Intel Pentium 2 processor, internet access, and in 2 years you can trade it in toward the purchase of a new one.
What do you call this thing? YourWare.
Call 1-800-GATEWAY, and let's talk about YourWare.
If your friend had a secret,
she's having an affair.
Would you expose the truth?
I cannot live the lie anymore.
A shocking new King of the Hill, 8, 7 Central, Fox Tuesday.
Now, while yesterday's game featured the home run ball, a lot of the hitters were talking about how difficult it was in the late afternoon to face Major League pitching, no matter who was on the mound, because of that glare in the background. Nagy was just dominating here yesterday for Cleveland. And the Red Sox hope that that glare will help the work of Pete Schourek. And the start this afternoon as Ramirez pops it up foul and out of play for strike one. And because that glare is so tough in a day game, a twilight game, here in the gloaming in Boston, that's why it's extra necessary to have that blacked out in center field, as you can see right there. Matter of fact, we played the 1967 series here, the Cardinals against the Red Sox, and those seats, there were people in it. You talk about hard to see with all those white shirts. Looked like about 100 baseballs coming at you when the pitcher wound up. Nothing in one to count on Manny Ramirez, who gets time from the home plate umpire Tim Sheeta. Ramirez this postseason with a couple of home runs and a few extra home run trots. Yeah, he has 4 home run trots and 2 home runs. Manny upset it himself after the second time that he trotted, thinking the ball was out of the ballpark in Cleveland. And he had a single on one, and then he had to bust it for a double on the second one. He was busting it out of the batter's box here yesterday, though, as Ramirez fouls it back and out of play. Yesterday, Manny Ramirez had a 2 home run game. This the shot off Brent Saberhagen in the 7th inning. But he wasn't finished. That one just got over the Green Monster and left, and then this laser beam into left that got out in a hurry off Dennis Eckersley, who looked stunned that Ramirez went down to get that ball. A good pitch down and in, and Ramirez shot it out of here for a 2-homer game. He's set up here at 0-2. That's that slider we were talking about, developed with Joe Kerrigan and the Red Sox. They call it the check swing slider. And here it is right here. You'll notice the parallel break in on the hands of Ramirez. That is a different look for Pete Schourek. Ramirez down the line, but hooking foul. That is not a different look from Manny Ramirez. Well, you talk about locked in. Talked about the 2 home runs and 11 total in the postseason for Manny Ramirez, a franchise record. That's the one thing that Manny has been able to do lately, handle the ball upstairs. He broke into the big leagues as a low ball hitter, but handles the high pitch better. There are the 11 home runs and where they stack up. All-time postseason home run leaders, yet get out a boatload of asterisks. Just the first couple of guys didn't have the wild card, the division series, the LCS. Ramirez into left field. Schourek had him reaching for it. Pete has retired the first 4 Indians in order. Joe, you're talking about the glare. I think it would behoove the Red Sox if that sun stays out for another 2 or 3 innings. When the sun goes behind the clouds, it's much easier to hit here. And I think it, as you said, favors Schourek much more than it would a guy like Colon. Schourek needs it. Colon doesn't. Well, we've had shade. There's some clouds overhead, and they roll by, so at times we've played in shade. Fryman into left field. Back at the track is O'Leary to play it off the wall. Midway up, and Fryman has a double. First hit for Cleveland. Halfway up the Green Monster in left. O'Leary was back there acting, Tim, as though he was going to catch the ball, and it hit halfway up the wall.
Well, you've got to explain this to me. Why decoy anybody when there's nobody on base? I can understand if you have a man on first, a man on second. But if you have the hitter, what is this designed to do? Get the hitter not to run? Well, he's going to be running anyway. Why is Troy O'Leary decoying in that situation? Doesn't make any sense to me.
Manny Ramirez has already learned his lesson. He would have been running. He did here yesterday. And Travis Fryman is a guy you don't have to worry about.
Right.
And he ends up with a one-out double. Now Jim Thome, 2 out of 12 with those two home runs in this division series with Boston. 30 homers on the regular year for Thome. And he bats with a runner at second, one out. He's up on the count, 2-0.
I think the one reason that Mike Hargrove feels comfortable with three left-handers in the lineup today is that Pete Schourek doesn't have a pitch that is designed to go inside the left-handed batters. Everything goes away, allowing the left-handed batters to really aggressively go into the ball. You don't have to worry about that tailing fastball.
The 2-0 from Schourek is down and away for ball three, 3-0. Richie Sexton waits on deck. A perfect first inning for Schourek. Retired Ramirez to start the inning. Now a double by Fryman and the 3-0 pitch to Thome. On four straight, a walk to put two on here in the second inning for Cleveland. Bring in Richie Sexton, who took over at first base when Jim Thome went down, breaking that bone in his right hand. Thome did, missed 6 weeks, went down August 7th. And Richie Sexton stepped in and shocked everybody with the way he pounded the ball over the wall. He hit 11 home runs in only 174 at-bats. Two on, one out. Ball one just inside for Schourek.
You have a big strike zone for which to throw with Sexton up there. 6-inch. Strike zone from here to Boston Commons. This pitch just inside.
So five in a row have missed from Schourek. That's full foul.
John Hart, the general manager of the Indians, went out and obtained Cecil Fielder from the California Angels. Or the Anaheim Angels. There's John and his wife. And then when Cecil Fielder kind of got Cecil because of insurance, and then when Richie Sexton ditched the well, then they released Cecil Fielder, assured that Sexton could do the job.
Runner stealing third. That's Fryman, and he picked everybody off. Schourek didn't pay enough attention. Hatteberg didn't even try a throw, and it's first and third, only one out.
That's a timing steal. Third base is easier to steal than second base. No one's holding you on, even though there is a shorter throw. But Travis Fryman timing Pete Schourek. And bang, he's gone. Hatteberg, the ball got caught up in the web, and Scott couldn't get it out of there in time, so he just ate it.
The pitch was a strike. It's 1-2 on Sexton. First and third, one out. Sexton strikes out. A big strikeout. And the first of the afternoon for Schourek.
Three fastballs and now the curveball and a huge strikeout for Schourek. So Cologne had a big strikeout of Mo Vaughn in the first. And Schourek here, Sexton in the second.
Schourek has faced Cleveland this season while with Houston. He got a no decision and pitched rather well, five innings. One run on just six hits on June 26th. Houston eventually lost that game to the Indians. Now with first and third, two out, here's Alomar.
and he takes a strike. Alomar had a down season offensively during the regular year, and the postseason hitting 300, 3 out of 10. To the shortstop, big pickup by Garcia Parra. That was a rocket. And Garcia Parra with a backhanded stab to force at second, and Schourek is through two scoreless innings. Bottom of the second in Boston, no score.
Day one, on the road,
in the air,
to cover Major League Baseball.
It's the year of the home run, my friend. Jack City, we're watching the big boys launch the long-range missiles over and over again, higher and higher. In fact, this ball right here is a ball that Mark McGwire launched into the propeller of the Bud 1 airship, proving that he is the Red Menace.
Hey, man, call the FAA. These guys are a threat to our airspace.
I believe I can call.
I think I'll use the foam in the hall.
I call my swings just to take
with 5 limbs one day from MCI.
My Space Jam buddies and I stay in close touch with MCI's 5 cents Sunday.
Just 5 cents a minute.
Every minute. Every Sunday.
Along with low weights. Low rates all week long. Call 1-800-SUNDAYS to become an MCI customer.
I believe I can call.
Welcome, Dave. It's been a long time.
Sure has, Red.
You got a spicy chicken sandwich. But here, try this.
Not bad.
Water?
No, thanks.
Ooh.
Now try Wendy's spicy chicken.
Wendy's spicy chicken sandwich is a whole breast fillet seasoned with Dave's own blend of pepper and spices. It's one very delicious, very spicy sandwich.
Plate.
Try Wendy's spicy chicken sandwich and long live the king.
We thought it was going to be another routine pit stop. Then the guys in R&D gave us this new advanced battery. Should be interesting.
Well, hello.
Trick or treat.
Mmm, thank you. Nestle Crunch. It's just more fun to munch.
The American League Division Series on Fox is brought to you by Brewery Fresh Budweiser, the official beer of Major League Baseball, and by Aflac, insuring over 40 million people worldwide.
So keep an eye on the traps. Anything you hit to the left, you know, deep, make sure you go down close to second in case it does come off the wall.
Yeah.
All right? Okay, be ready now. Watch the line drive in front of you.
The voice of Al Bumbry, the first base coach for Cleveland, talking to Jim Thome as O'Leary hits a bullet to the right side, picked up by Enrique Wilson, one away.
And reminding Jim Thome that the wall influences almost everything anybody does in this ballpark. The wall, the monster. There it is.
And that's not the only tough part with playing the outfield here at Fenway Park. The wall is part of it, but it is asymmetrical with a capital A. One out, nobody on, and a strike over the outside corner to Hattieburg. They're talking about the different angles that you have to play as an outfielder here at Fenway Park. And it can become a headache in a hurry. Hattieburg takes the pitch low and away, 1-1.
Yeah, this is this ballpark, and what a national treasure it is the just the opposite of the cookie cutter stadiums that came in the late 60s and early 70s.
More angles than a Ken Starr investigation. I mean, it's one after another. And then there's an angle on top of another angle in left center field and in right center field as Hattieburg takes the strike of the outside corner, 2-2. Hattieburg batting with one out, nobody on, and Benjamin to follow. That's out in right center, 420. Hattieburg takes high, and a count full, 3-2 from Cologne, who got around a leadoff double and a walk in the first. Yeah.
walk handed out by Colon. We will tell you that today's overhead shots are courtesy of the Goodyear Blimp Stars and Stripes based in Pompano Beach, Florida. At the controls, Captain Jim Maloney from Vienna, Virginia. If you want to know what it's like to face a young 23-year-old fireballing right-hander, Bartolo Colon, this at bat for you from catcher cam as Benjamin tips it foul for strike one.
You do not have a lot of time to react. That ball sinking in on the hands of Mike Benjamin. My dream matchup in postseason play, you never know whether you're going to get it, but Mike Benjamin against Terry Leitenberg of the Braves.
Because of the facial hair.
Sideburns.
Nothing in one. The count, one on, one out, and that pitch up and in, and you can see the helmet of Benjamin ducking through your picture as he at least was chased off the plate.
Yeah, Colon trying to separate those sideburns right there. Mike saying that even his children, he has three children, and even his children get on him with one of those dead.
A lot of time in front of the mirror. One on, one out. Benjamin showing bunt, taking a pitch high, 2-1. And Alomar, the veteran catcher, out to talk to his young right hander.
It's the right count to hit and run, but not the right pitcher. Jimmy Williams saying Bartolo Colon, not only a high ball pitcher, but wild, and he takes that into consideration. That's the number one thing, the control of a pitcher before he decides to hit and run or not.
Benjamin, a good swing on a pitch up, 2-2. One thing you can see from the catcher cam angle, not only that you don't get a lot of time to react, but as you take a look back out at Bartolo Colon, see how tough it is to pick up the ball with that glare in the background.
Yeah.
I mean, it's out of that shadow. The hitter's background as Benjamin floats one into left. David Justice comes on and makes a sliding catch. Throw behind the runner. Sexton's foot was off the bag and Hattieburg back anyway. That would have been a heck of a double play. Great front end from David Justice.
I'll tell you, I think David Justice made such a good play. He picked Richie Sexton off first base. Justice made a play like this in yesterday's game. The sliding catch, the spin, blind throw to first. What if Sexton were on the bag? It would have been very close. You're talking about a guy 6'8 who's stretching over there.
Sexton was never on the bag.
No.
Might have been caught watching the great catch of David Justice and left. And now the number 9 hitter, Darren Bragg. During the regular season, hit a career-high 279, is 1 out of 8 in this division series. Two and oh. Here's a listen to the sound of that catch by Justice. You can hear the first base coach, Dave Jouse, screaming to Hattieburg to get back, and then first base umpire Drew Coble calling him safe. Great play by David Justice. One on, two out, the 2-0 pitch. Bragg pops it up. Left side, looks playable. Freiman gives way to Vizquel, and the inning comes to a close. We move to inning number 3. We'll be back after this from Fox Sports, your home for the 1998 World Series. Back after this from your local station.
You're watching Fox, home of the 1998 World Series.
Because of our passion for design and engineering, our vehicles speak for themselves. And recently, others have had some great things to say about our quality, too. Sebring Convertible, Total Quality Award. Town and Country, Total Quality Award. Cirrus, Best in Class in Initial Quality by J.D. Power & Associates. Concord, Best in Class in Initial Quality by J.D. Power & Associates. Chrysler, engineered to be great cars.
Okay, who's in charge of finances at your house?
Well, here's something to make your life easier. The Fleet One Gold Account. It connects all your accounts, so it's easy to move money around or put it away for the future. You can bank by ATM, phone, PC, or the web. Even pay bills online. And it all shows up on one statement. The Fleet One Gold Account. One easy way into all Fleet has to offer. Fleet. We're ready when you are.
Building automobiles, Saab built airplanes. And when you build airplanes, we learn how to handle turbulence.
If it matters to you,
live from Pembroke.
It's on Fox 25 News.
One hit aside as we have played two. We go to the third. Pete Schourek back to work. Enrique Wilson, the number nine hitter, getting the start in place of Joey Cora, who has struggled 0-for-8 at the plate. And Enrique Wilson has been a top prospect in the Cleveland Indians organization, which is filled with prospects the last couple of years. Wilson first up, and he takes a strike as Hattieburg did a good job of pulling that pitch back into the strike zone. Can't do anything with that. One ball, one strike.
David Copperfield couldn't have pulled that one back into the strike zone.
And I'm not sure that I'd want to see him do it.
Be honest with you.
No. Wilson takes the ball. It's 2-1. Jimmy Williams wondering how this will turn out with Pete Schourek as he deals on 2-1. That's the most obvious statement you could make, but carries with it. And this start by Schourek carries with it a lot of history, which we will try to get through without dragging on at some point during the next couple of innings. Three balls and a strike, and Wilson pops it up near the mound, and Ballantyne wants it. Buddy Mauvin gives way. One out. Tomorrow it's a Fox NFL Sunday doubleheader, starting off with a classic NFC East matchup as the Cowboys take on the Redskins, followed by the Eagles battling with the Denver Broncos, plus other regional action. Coverage begins at noon Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific, right here on Fox. Here's Kenny Lofton. We will have a baseball game for you here tomorrow night. Somewhere, some city. If this series goes to a decisive fifth game, we'll bring it to you from Jacobs Field tomorrow night in Cleveland. Lofton pops it into right center field. A lot of room out there. And Darren Lewis in the sunlight puts it away. Two down. And just to further confuse you, we'll give you the other scenarios. AL Division Series Game 5, Boston and Cleveland if necessary. Game 4 of the Cubs-Braves Series if necessary. And that will depend on what happens tonight. Or the Astros at the Padres, we know that'll happen. Game 4. That's tomorrow night. If you're confused and you want it wrapped up succinctly, check out the Fox NFL Sunday pregame show and I'll lay it all out for you. Omar Vizquel takes a strike.
JB, Terry, Howie, and Chris have it all down.
A little flare into center. Long run, Darren Lewis. Good play. And a 1-2-3 inning for Pete Schourek. He's doing his part. Now the offense will try to kick it in for Boston. Top of the order for the Red Sox. Bottom of the third, no score.
generazioni, la famiglia Capece ha prodotto il miglior olio d'oliva di tutta l'Umbria. All'improvviso il mondo è cambiato. Globalizzazione, tragedia.
Perché piangi?
Piango perché tu devi partire per salvare la famiglia.
Ma nonna, c'è un modo nuovo di fare le cose. Io non devo partire.
Come? Mi fai piangere per niente.
Into your mind. All right, best bucket of fried chicken in the world. Try again. KFC. I know you got bucket on the brain. Looky here. I also make something new called popcorn chicken. Crunchy morsels of tender white meat. It's mouth-popping good. Try it for $1.99. See, I make a whole lot more than fried chicken in a bucket, because I am a chicken genius. At KFC, we do chicken right. And not just in a bucket, neither.
NFL Sunday, Dion and the boys battle the Skins, then the Eagles take on the Broncos. It's a Fox NFL Sunday doubleheader tomorrow.
Packed house here at Fenway Park as we prepare for the bottom of the third inning. Top of the order for Boston, Lewis, Valentin, and Mo Vaughn against Bartolo Colon. Darren Lewis, who has the only Red Sox hit, led off with a double back in the first inning, takes a strike. Five out of 11, a great division series being put together by the Red Sox leadoff man.
And a guy who really deserves a lot of credit. He is not a naturally gifted hitter. He's a hitter whose natural movement is that the hands come first. He drags the bat head through the strike zone, which means that he's going to hit a lot of balls to right field, particularly the fastball.
Well, that just missed. Two balls and a strike. Got Colon talking to himself as he did not get this call. So 2-1. A high strike, 2-2. Mention how much credit Darren Lewis deserves. Career highs in average, home runs, RBIs. A strikeout here in the third inning as Bartolo Colon gets Lewis looking. Let's hear from Cleveland manager Mike Hargrove on the start and the type of pitcher Bartolo Colon has become.
He brings somebody that throws the ball 98 miles an hour. I mean, that's a fairly unique ability to have in the game of baseball. If Bartolo can stay ahead of hitters and get his breaking ball over for strikes when he needs to, then Bartolo has a chance to dominate the game.
That misses outside for ball one to Valentin.
I'll tell you how tough Colon can be. There were 49 players in the American League that hit over 300. 49. That was a composite average of those 49 players, 317. Against Bartolo Colon, those 49 players hit 218.
That's low, 3-0. John Hart, general manager of the Cleveland Indians, on your right. Watching the 23-year-old right-hander run the count to 3-0 on Valentin with Mo Vaughn next. That caught the corner, a 96-mile-per-hour pitch, so Colon didn't let up to throw a strike. And it's 3-1. Valentin, a base hit into right. And John is on base for the second time this afternoon.
For Mo Vaughn to have somebody on when he comes up, and Valentin sees to that with a single to right center.
Well, two hits for Boston. Both have been to the right side from right-handed batters. This is that good fastball from Bartolo Colon, and now Mo Vaughn. Struck out with two on and nobody out back in the first. Double play ball to short. Mescal flips. Wilson in the middle. And the inning comes to a close. The big double play off the bat of Mo Vaughn, who is now 0 for 2. Colon, Schourek, three scoreless innings as we go to the fourth. Who is the last American League player to win the AL MVP and play for a World Series champion in the same year? It takes you back into the last decade. Not that far back, but still a tester.
I think that's a fair hint. It was in the 80s.
The mid-80s.
Yeah.
David Justice, Manny Ramirez, Travis Fryman as the Indians try to get a lead and get back to the ALCS.
Pete Schourek on his normal 4 days rest. And should the Red Sox win, Pedro Martinez will pitch tomorrow in Cleveland. 4 days rest. And you may be wondering if there was any precedent. Fans here at Fenway Park in the New England area, Red Sox fans, remember gentleman Jim Lonborg, who started two games of the 1967 series on 3 days rest and one on 2 days rest, faced Bob Gibson in game seven. And there are a lot of people in New England, and I'm not too sure that they don't have a very good point. Gibson was almost unbeatable in those days, but had Lonborg had one more day's rest, the Red Sox would have had a much better chance to beat the Cardinals.
Justice started to throw the bat away on that 3-1 pitch, called a strike. So 3-2 on the leadoff hitter, Justice, here in the fourth.
Right on the corner with the 3-1 fastball.
Now the 3-2. Justice reaching for it. Mo Vaughn stays down on it, one away. And Justice is 0 for 2.
Joe, in that 67 series after game one, I saw something that I'd never seen before or since. Right there in center field, that's where the batting cage is kept here at Fenway Park. And Carl Yastrzemski, after game one, he went 0 for 4, and he had the ground crew haul out the batting cage, and he took extra hitting after 163 games of the season. The next day, he had two-run home runs against Dick Hughes and Joe Horner. So the batting practice worked.
Manny Ramirez takes a pitch inside. Well, you start going down a list. There's the number. One of the five retired numbers when you add Jackie Robinson's number 42 here at Fenway Park. You start going down a list, and you start going down a list of the great players. They weren't great just by luck. The great players also seem to have a great work ethic.
Oh, yeah.
And that's a good example of it. Had a chance all year to follow Mark McGwire around, and he did a lot of the same things. For the final game of the season, was in taking extra batting practice in the batting cage, and ends up popping two more home runs, getting to 70. A breaking ball for a strike to make it 1-2 on Manny Ramirez.
Now, there were guys with whom I played that had equal work habits as Yaz, but nobody worked harder than Carl Yastrzemski at becoming a great ball player. What a great player he was.
A ball and two strikes, one out, nobody on. Manny Ramirez at the plate. Ramirez jammed, and he fought it off.
That's a good sequence right there. The fastball away for the first strike, then the curveball away, and then Schourek and Hattaberg tried to come back inside to Ramirez. But as we said earlier, Ramirez much more proficient at that high inside fastball now than he has been in past years.
1-2, the count on Ramirez. One out, nobody on. Same pitch, same result as it gets out of play. Still 1-2.
1-2, and how'd you get there? We were talking about the sequence. First pitch misses inside. Now the second pitch. Now watch the curve. Curveball to the outside part. Now he's trying to come inside. That was the slider, that last one. Still 1-2 to Manny Ramirez. Remember, it's not the location of the pitch, but how you got there that makes it effective.
Ramirez pops it up. They came in on him again, and Benjamin waits, puts it away, two up, two down.
So you saw the first five pitches, and here's the one that finishes Manny off. High inside fastball. Anybody who has questioned Pete Schourek's velocity, I think they've been convinced through this first 3 2/3 innings. Jimmy Williams, Joe Kerrigan telling us that right around 90 pitches, and that's when they'll think about having Schourek removed.
Fryman starts out with an 0-1 count. Schourek has thrown 46 pitches. So maybe halfway there. 90's the mark. That is strike two as they appeal to Drew Coble. And it's 0-2 on Fryman, who doubled high off the wall his first time up.
Remember, we talked about the check swing slider. That was it right there. Effective. Another one.
And a 1-2 count. Justice grounded out. Ramirez popped out. Just low. 2-2.
After this pitch, Pete Schourek was heading for the barn, but just low, says Tim Tashita.
And now the 2-2. From 0-2 to 3-2. On deck is Tomey and Sexton, and as we told you during the open of this telecast, down through this lineup, Mike Hargrove puts one run producer after another. Two out, nobody on, three balls, two strikes. From 0-2 to a walk, and the second walk handed out by Schourek this afternoon. That'll bring in Jim Tomey, who walked his first time.
Jim Tomey with a home run on a changeup from Brett Saberhagen yesterday. He is a very patient hitter. He does not swing at too many balls, likes the ball up and out over the plate. And he is a premier long-distance man. He has hit some crushing home runs for the Indians in his career.
You got Saberhagen here yesterday hitting it into the camera well out in center field. And that's a strike over the outside corner. Here's the shot off the bat of Tomey in the fifth inning. Going and going and going. Right off the camera. On the runner Fryman, who has already stolen a base in this game. So Schourek pays more attention now. Fryman stole third back in the second. It was first and third, one out, when Schourek came up with his only strikeout. The perfect spot for Boston as he got Sexton. Yee.
Pete Schourek does not have a good move to first base because he does not have a big leg kick. There's nothing deceptive in that right leg of his. It's where a lot of your left-handers have great moves to first because they deceive when the leg goes up. But you can see that's not a big leg kick right there.
And now Schourek has Tommy set up at 0-2. And this crowd again, they may have filed through the gates wishing for a Pedro Martinez start, but they are fully behind Schourek now, who has allowed no runs on only one Cleveland hit so far. Breaking ball had Tommy bailing 1-2.
See, Pete Schourek is not a classic power pitcher. He has neither the slide step nor the high leg kick.
The 1-2 to Tommy. Instead, another check on Freeman. That's three. Throws over to first. With Freeman at first. It does have Vaughn on the bag and open up a hole on the right side of the infield. Now Freeman's running. They have him picked off. Tagged by Vaughn. Caught stealing. 1-3, 6-3 to end the inning. So Travis Freeman, who's been bothered by a bad back in the second half of the season, got his rest last night. He's already stolen one. Now caught stealing. As we go to the bottom of the fourth, no score.
$99 a month. A hot set of wheels with money left to burn. Sunfire. See it at your Pontiac dealer today.
Is your dandruff sending the wrong signals? Get Selsun Power. Doctors recommend Selsun Blue number one. So don't send the wrong signals. Get Selsun Power.
You guys watch too many movies.
Nestle Bunch of Crunch. It's just more fun to munch.
They say the game these days is all about money. Well, not for the beer man. For the beer man, it's still about passion. When I crack open a cold Coors Light, I give 110%. Just like those guys in the Rockies. And when a fan shouts, "Hey, beer man!" that frost brew refreshment is delivered like an inside fastball. No, it's not about money.
It's about exercise. I gotta drop some pounds.
Cool is right! It's just cool is right here!
I'm looking for Pine Street.
Go down to the fork in the road.
Right, but make sure you take the left fork.
Right.
Then you see a big brown dog.
Keep straight.
Two blocks down the street, you see a man named Slappy selling meth.
But don't buy one.
You already got one.
Right. Hang a right at Slappy.
That's a left, right?
A right.
Left.
Left. Right. Right. Right.
Okay.
Right.
Keep straight. Watch out for the goat.
Then you see a big McDonald's and...
Did somebody say McDonald's?
Aren't you glad we brought you here?
I'm glad.
Sue learns to drive.
Get the cats out of the driveway.
With the queen of road rage.
I want to give him a finger.
There you go!
An all-new Costello Tuesday after King of the Hill on Fox.
Nomar Garciaparra digs in to lead it off for the Red Sox in the bottom of the fourth inning. There is no score. Garciaparra into deep right center. Ramirez back. Goodbye. 1-0 Boston.
Oh.
finally takes a strike over the inside corner. Garcia Parra now with three home runs and 11 RBIs in this series. 1-1 on Stanley. Swing there, but strike two as Cologne tries to bounce back after this.
A breaking ball away, up in his eyes, but not for long. Tremendous power the other way by a guy who weighs 175 pounds. Wiry, and you talk about strong. Wow.
The 1-2, Stanley up the middle. Vizquel keeps it on the infield and gets the out. What a play by Omar Vizquel. Stanley does not run well, which allowed Vizquel the chance. The ball off the mound, up the middle, and into the glove of a five-time Gold Glove Award winner.
Had that ball not been slowed down, it was hit hard enough to get by Vizquel, but because it was slowed down, it allows a guy as acrobatic almost as Ozzie Smith at shortstop to make the play. Almost.
Now O'Leary comes up empty. What a play by Omar Vizquel to his left.
Watch the mound slow it down. Cologne did not get a glove on the ball, I didn't think. But a fine play by Vizquel.
Omar has won five consecutive Gold Glove Awards, and number six ought to come his way after this 1998 season, in which he had a fielding percentage of .993, made only five errors. O'Leary pops it up left side near the Cleveland dugout for Freiman. Two out here in the Boston fourth inning. So a leadoff home run by Garcia Parra. Stanley grounded out. O'Leary fouls out. Scott Hanneberg, the catcher who walked his first time, digs in with two out, nobody on. In this series for Boston, of the 19 RBIs, Garcia Parra has 11, Vaughn 7, all coming in the first game. Veritek has the other. One and one on Hedberg.
There's only one guy that I saw here in Boston that had consistent power to right center field over the Boston bullpen, and that was Jim Rice, the hitting instructor of the Red Sox. But Jim, a much bigger man than Omar Garcia Parra. But I mean, you talk about strong. This guy used to hit him over the Boston bullpen with regularity.
Hedberg into deep center field, lofted and back. On the track to pull it in. From catcher cam, a look at Garcia Parra's third of the series. In and out and over the wall in right center for a 1-0 Boston lead after four.
These the trendsetters, the fashion forward, the avant-garde. These are the professionals who drove trucks before they were the in thing. The new GMC Envoy is designed to their standards. Because now that the subdivision's getting crowded with pseudo-trucks, we thought it's about time there's a luxury SUV that's as solid and as hardy and as true as a GMC truck. The new Envoy by GMC.
I love lobster.
Boiled lobster.
Broiled lobster.
Jumbo lobster.
Baked stuffed lobster.
Steamed lobster.
Lobster Newberg.
Lobster tail.
There he goes again.
Lobster roll.
Sauteed lobster.
Did I mention lobster stew?
Boiled.
The Cook's Lobster House off the coast of Maine, they'll give you lobster just about any way you want it. But bring your Visa card, because you won't get a bite using American Express.
Sir, any suggestions?
There's boiled lobster.
Visa, it's everywhere you want to be.
Well, Gary, what Nintendo sports game would you like to play today?
There's Kobe Bryant and NBA wiping the floor with Gary courtside. Major League Gary bashing
with Ken Griffey Jr.
NHL Gary's going down on ice!
WWF Gary in the Turnbuckle War Zone!
Nintendo Sports. What friends are for.
What?
Due to circumstances beyond our control, tonight's game is canceled.
Take your skates off, ain't you?
What's up, Coach?
The game's postponed.
What?
What do you mean?
Some guy came in with a Wendy's spicy chicken sandwich.
Oh, they're good.
It was so hot, the ice melted.
Again?
Oh, for the love of Pete.
Wendy's spicy chicken is a whole breast fillet seasoned with Dave's own blend of pepper and spices. It's one hot sandwich.
That's the second time this week, Dave. Sorry.
Wendy's spicy chicken, when you're hot, you're hot.
Where would you turn for the best sports news? With 3,500 pro games a year, we are your news source. Fox Sports News, better because we are there.
Well, now Pete Schourek has a one-run lead as we go into the fifth inning. Tomey, who was at the plate when Fryman was out stealing. Then Sexton, then Sandy Alomar. Indians trail by one, and Tomey grounds one to the right side. Bovon took it away. One out. He may be 0 for 2 at the plate, but Mo Vaughn has made his presence felt in this game with a glove.
Watch Mo Vaughn, the quick steps and the dive to smother it over to Schourek covering. Fine play by Mo Vaughn. That's his third good play in this ball game.
So one out, and Richie Sexton digs in. And a strike over the inside corner. There's that check swing slider, and Sexton checked it. One ball, one strike.
That slider that Schourek throws, rarely a strike. But it looks like a strike, and that's why you get the check swings. Only to right-handed batters will he throw that.
Two balls and a strike. Schourek is still allowed only one hit. Pitched around, two walks. Three balls and a strike on Sexton.
A young power hitter like Sexton wants the ball inside part of the plate as you look at Sandy Alomar. Sexton wants to tie it right here.
He tried, came up empty, 3-2. Three balls, two strikes on Richie Sexton. Sexton hit 11 home runs in the big leagues, 21 at AAA Buffalo. The 61st pitch of the game from Schourek is ball four, down and into Sexton. Our Aflac trivia question: who is the last American League player to win the AL MVP and play for a World Series champion in the same year? The Aflac trivia answer: did you remember Willie Hernandez, 1984 with the Detroit Tigers?
Sparky Anderson's Tigers that year won 35 of their first 40 games, sailed to a World Series championship against San Diego.
San Diego that year defeated the Cubs to get there. One on, one out. Two and oh, and a visit from Mo Vaughn to Pete Schourek.
Tell you, Joe, the interesting thing about that shot from catcher cam on the Garciaparra home run was how Sandy Alomar's glove came up right before Garciaparra made contact. Let's watch again. When a pitcher is going to throw a breaking ball and you see the catcher's glove come up, that's a bad sign. Those high breaking balls, you don't catch those.
Two balls, no strikes on Alomar after the walk to Sexton. And now 3-0. So over the 60 pitch mark is Schourek. And again, Joe Kerrigan, Jimmy Williams, putting a 90 pitch mark on Schourek's start here today. Back-to-back walks to Sexton and Alomar, and the Indians are threatening here in the fifth inning. Down by a run, Cleveland has two on, one out, with the number nine hitter Enrique Wilson coming up.
The second baseman, Enrique Wilson.
Jimmy Williams telling us that if he makes a move in the middle innings, it will probably be Derek Lowe, particularly if it's a double play situation, because he thinks Lowe has the best sinker on his ball club from the bullpen.
Wilson takes a ball, and now the crowd starting to get restless as Schourek has gone wild here in the fifth inning. It is Lowe getting ready now for the Red Sox out of their bullpen. Look back at second. Sexton the lead runner. Sandy Alomar is the trail runner. And a one ball, no strike count on Enrique Wilson. Two on, one out. Another one out of the strike zone from Schourek. Derek Lowe better get ready in a hurry.
That's seven straight balls from Pete Schourek. And he's missing in the same spot, and that's bad. Low and away to right-handed batters. The one thing you do not want to do in a situation like this is coax a ball back into the strike zone. That is when a guy on a 2-0, 2-1 pitch can hurt you with a long ball. And Wilson has power.
Here it is on 2-0. Enrique Wilson at the plate now, the left-handed hitting Lofton on deck. Red Sox leading by one in the fifth. Wilson pops it up. Bragg back to get it. Sexton tags and advances. It's first and third, two out. So the tying run 90 feet away. The go-ahead run is at first. And with two out, it's going to be up to Kenny Lofton for the Indians.
That's not an incidental going to third base by Sexton, because if you're on third with two outs and you have a hitter like Lofton, there are a lot of things that Lofton can do to tie this game up. Sexton tagging up, he goes to third without a play. But it's a lot different being on third base with two out and a speedster like Lofton up than a guy who can't run.
And at the very top of the list is an infield hit.
Yeah, or a butt base hit.
Lofton in this series, 5 out of 14, and he bats with first and third, two out. 1-0, the Red Sox leading here in the fifth. Back-to-back walks to Sexton and Alomar put Schourek in trouble. Got Wilson on the fly ball to right, and now misses badly with a pitch down and away to Lofton.
Fine play by Scott Hedeberg. Quick feet.
One ball, no strikes on Lofton. 1-1. Kenny Lofton homered here yesterday and has driven in four runs in this series. Now up over 70 is Schourek. Two and one. Is Kel next? Schourek one way or the other might be facing his last batter here with Lofton. That's pulled foul. And the count 2-2. Here's what Kenny Lofton did here yesterday. This shot off Saberhagen in the sixth inning put Cleveland out in front. Out in front for good. Two balls, two strikes on Lofton, first and third, two out. The Red Sox facing elimination this afternoon against the Indians. Just high, 3-2. And now the runner at first, Alomar, will get a head start.
Schourek tried the slider to Lofton. That was high. Yes, it was, Kenny. Right.
Into right center field. Darren Lewis over to get it. Inning over. Schourek, two walks. We're through 4.5. 1-0 Boston.
Hey, what are you doing?
I'm just watching some home movies.
Oh, look at that little ball of dough. Is that you?
You got a very good eye. That is me. And look over there. That's you. Remember this? Sauce made from vine-ripened tomatoes.
Sure.
100% real mozzarella.
That's beautiful pepperoni.
This just brings back a lot of memories. I'm flooded.
We grew up so.
Are you crying?
No, it's the onion.
Really? I can see you tearing up.
No.
Get two Little Caesars pizzas featuring our authentic 1959 recipe and three toppings for just $10.99.
Pizza, pizza.
I actually got in.
You broke into personnel.
Yeah, these are salaries of every person in the company.
Look, this senior VP makes about half as much as this senior VP. Betty doesn't know that.
Sure he does. I just emailed everybody in the company.
Airport perform at 8 o'clock flight. Maybe we can talk. Otherwise,
foot
over.
Ah! Come on, I'll start. Oh no! That battery.
No matter what my customers drive, they depend on AC Delco batteries. They last up to 30% longer.
I'm sure they do. Just give me the generic equipment, okay?
AC Delco. If you're not asking for it,
battery!
You're asking for it.
The American League Division Series on Fox is brought to you by Dr. Pepper and your local Dr. Pepper bottler. Dr. Pepper, this is the taste. And by MasterCard, official card of Major League Baseball and fan of the great American pastime.
A beautiful day in Boston. It's cool. It's October. Providing our shots from above is the Goodyear blimp Stars and Stripes. Pompano Beach, Florida. The 192-foot blimp travels to an average of 40 cities each year. We thank them for their help in our telecast here from Fenway as Mike Benjamin leads off and hits it to center. Kenny Lofton in to make the catch, one away. Here is the reaction of Pete Schourek after getting Lofton to end the top of this fifth. Second, that ball left the bat of Lofton. He knew it was out number three. Darren Lewis made it official, and beat Schourek is through five.
That will be about as much emotion as you will see Pete Schourek show.
One out, nobody on for Bragg, and that's a ball up and away.
But still, for the Red Sox, nothing from the bottom of the order. Nothing. Five through nine, not a hit. One base runner. That was Scott Hedeberg, a one-out walk in the second inning.
They combined 9 out of 67 in this series, five through nine. Darren Bragg fouled out his first time up. Red Sox leading by one in the fifth, and that's up 2-1. Right now, the Boston bullpen is quiet. So by getting around those back-to-back walks in the fifth inning, Pete Schourek may have bought himself another inning.
I think they're looking, or Jimmy Williams is looking for one more inning. Schourek has thrown 75 pitches. We told you folks that he was looking right at that 90-pitch mark, so one would have to assume, unless it's a 1-2-3 and five pitches, that Schourek will be through after the sixth inning.
High heat from Cologne. Two balls, two strikes on Darren Bragg, who is one out of nine in this series. Mike Hargrove getting what he wanted and needed out of Bartolo Colon. But not getting the typical Cleveland offense against Pete Schourek. The Indians still have only one hit. Back to the top of the order after Bragg. Darren Lewis waits on deck. One out, base is clear, and a three ball, two strike count on Darren Bragg.
This is one of those catch me if you can at bats. Darren Bragg knows what's coming. Everybody in the ballpark knows the fastball's coming, but at 97, 98 miles an hour, up in the zone, it's tough to get around on.
Again on 3-2, and Bragg pops it into shallow right. Out goes Wilson, in comes Ramirez, two gone. Joe Buck and Tim McCarver with you, along with our producer John Filippelli, our director Bill Webb. This game summary is brought to you by MCI. Garcia Parra has provided the only run of the afternoon, a solo home run in the fourth inning. Pete Schourek threw five innings, only one hit. Bartolo Colon doing his part, 4 2/3 innings, one run on just three hits. And each side has struggled with runners in scoring position. Combined 0-for-7. Defensively, Mo Vaughn has been a star for the Red Sox. Again, Boston, if they lose this afternoon to Cleveland, they are finished. The Indians will be back in the LCS. They've been there two of the last three seasons. We already know that the New York Yankees will be there. They finished off the Texas Rangers late last night after a 3-hour plus rain delay. Who will earn the right to face them in the ALCS? 2-1 now on Darren Lewis.
Speaking of earning the right, how about the Yankees holding the Texas Rangers and their vaunted offense to one run in three games? Rusty Greer, Will Clark, Ivan Rodriguez, Juan Gonzalez, 4-for-44 during the three-game series. Remarkable.
Two balls and a strike. Lewis the other way, 2-2.
Joe Torre telling us before game one that if we don't pitch, we don't win. Did they ever pitch? Yankees only scored 9 runs.
Doesn't take much, though, when you have that kind of pitching, and they were looking for some work for their bullpen. Two balls, two strikes. Lewis strikes out. That's number three on the afternoon for Cologne. He has pitched well. We have played five. Schourek back to work. 1-0 Boston.
Happy birthday.
Oh, good. Another apple. Where's Danny?
Oh, you can tell by the way I use my walk. I'm a woman.
Breakthrough to the new world of Mach 3 from Gillette. The first triple blade shaving system. Three blades specially positioned to shave progressively closer. You take one stroke, it takes three. So you don't have to shave the same area over and over, which means less irritation. Three blades, fewer strokes, less irritation. Mach 3 from Gillette.
Windows makes computers easier, right? But this point and click thing doesn't quite work if you can't see the screen. So we built in technology that makes computers easier for the blind. We first have to throw away the mouse.
Good morning.
Then we make the computer talk to you.
Reduction studio.
If you make a computer easy to use by someone who's disabled, you learn how to make computers easy for everyone.
Available with up to $710 in option package savings. Alero by Oldsmobile. Start something.
Feel it like never before. The Lost World with all new scenes. Sunday, November 1st on Fox.
Well, we would like to thank Sandy Alomar Jr. for agreeing to wear the catcher cam. And we give you a look at that last strikeout as Darren Lewis was blown away by Bartolo Colon. See that pitch dive a little down and in. And again, thanks to Sandy Alomar Jr. Thank Ivan Rodriguez and Scott Service. Kind enough to give us those rare looks at what it's like to face Colon or Pete Schourek or whomever. One ball, one strike.
Catcher cam's running out of light.
That's right. I don't think he'll agree to put a floodlight on top of the thing. One ball, one strike. 2-1. Explain that.
I can't.
Two balls and a strike. Mescal pops it foul back here. Tomorrow is the 50th anniversary of the first ever playoff game in American League history. 1948. Cleveland player manager Lou Boudreau had a big game. Two homers, two run singles as Boston faced Cleveland. Cleveland winning the game 8-3. It was an interesting choice of pitchers by then-manager Joe McCarthy.
Joe McCarthy going with Denny Gailhouse instead of Mel Parnell then. Great left-hander. Not too many great left-handers in this ballpark pitching for this team. Bill Lee comes to mind. Everybody talking about Bill Lee. I was a spaceman and all that. He could pitch. 17-game winner 4 years in a row in this ballpark.
Who pitched for Cleveland? Knuckleballer Gene Bearden, who was working on one day of rest.
Yeah, how about that?
Wow. Joe McCarthy, the manager, came under fire for his choice for his starting pitcher that day, and fans around here haven't forgiven Darryl Johnson, 1975. Pinch hitting for Jim Willoughby, the reliever. He's in game 7 against Cincinnati as Vizquel fouls it away.
And Burton came on, gave up the what was the winning run. And now Jimmy Williams today. I mean, the fans around here have long memories.
Yeah. Yep.
Jimmy Williams today said, I'm going with Pete Schourek. The common feeling was Pedro Martinez was the right choice. Well, Schourek is working here in the sixth inning, and he gets Vizquel on a pop-up on the infield. Third baseman Ballant's in there, one away. So while we are digging into the history books, we look at what happened 20 years ago yesterday. October 2nd, 1978, another playoff. And it was another disappointing result for the Red Sox. The home run by Bucky Dent, of all people, off Mike Torres. A dramatic three-run home run in the seventh inning. And the Yankees went on to the postseason. The Red Sox had to do another wait till next year. So Jimmy Williams is a guy that you know better than I know. He's a guy who a couple of days ago said flat out, I'm going with Pete Schourek. He's been under fire around here for making that decision. Everybody's been questioning that decision. And here is Schourek working on a one-hit shutout in the sixth inning with a resting Pedro Martinez over on the dugout bench, hoping he'll get a chance to work tomorrow night in Cleveland.
Well, and if Pedro does work tomorrow night in Cleveland, I mean, the odds go back to the Red Sox as favorites in tomorrow night's game, even though, as we mentioned earlier, the great Cleveland Indian fans, and they do make a difference. That narrows the odds a bit. But you'd have to pick the Red Sox tomorrow night if they win here tonight with that guy going.
A ball and two strikes. They paid a dear price in players and in money to bring him here. $75 million. Some good young talent, including Carl Bavano, to Montreal. But right now, all eyes on Schourek. The 1-2 to Justice. Well hit into center field. Lewis is back. He will play it off the wall. And Justice has a one-out double. Ball kept slicing away from Lewis into one of the bigger parts of this park. David Justice has a one-out double, and looks like that's it for Pete Schourek, and we'll hear what kind of an ovation Schourek gets for his effort here this afternoon.
Pitches, three shy of the 90 Jimmy Williams was talking about before the game.
Fenway Park said Shuey going to break. Shuey continues to loosen up out in the Cleveland bullpen as they go to Steve Reed. Out of the bullpen, did not have good numbers while with the Indians, with San Francisco at the start of the year. For the better part of the season, he was automatic. He deals inside to Darren Lewis with an extra run at second with two out here in the seventh.
And that is not unusual for Steve Reed to deal from downstairs. He is a side armor and the running fastball inside of the right-handed batters. Very tough to pull.
The pop-up on the infield, and Freiman wants it. Travis puts it away, and a leadoff walk turns into nothing for the Red Sox. We go to the eighth inning. Game four of this series, the Red Sox lead by one.
These AC Delco parts are about the most dependable you can buy. They should really help improve your performance.
Come on, they're all the same. I'll take some out of this bushel basket.
Okay.
AC Delco, no matter what you drive, if you're not asking for it, you're asking for it.
Thank you. I don't want to buy a new PC every year till commencement.
I needed one that would keep up with them.
Gotta save something for college.
Introducing YourWare from Gateway. Call 1-800-GATEWAY and we'll custom build you a Gateway PC with an Intel Pentium 2 processor
and DVD, now for only $39 a month. And in 2 years, you can trade it in toward the purchase of a new one.
You guys make sneakers?
Call us now and let's talk about YourWare from Gateway.
Well, well, look at you. You are one good-looking pizza.
Me? No, my friend. You are the good-looking pizza.
Please, don't be modest. Look at those toppings.
Why, my toppings? Forget about it. Look at your toppings. Pepperoni, green pepper. Wait, is that onion?
Yeah, I got a little onion.
Yeah, kill them.
Well, look at you, Mr. Ham.
Oh.
Mr. Mushroom. Mr., could you possibly fit any more pepperoni on me?
Oh, stop. Get in the bag.
Get two Little Caesars pizzas featuring our authentic 1959 recipe and three toppings for just $10.99.
Pizza, pizza.
On Fox NFL Sunday, Dion and the boys battle the Skins. Then the Eagles take on the Broncos. It's a Fox NFL Sunday doubleheader tomorrow.
Our overhead coverage tonight, courtesy of the Goodyear Blimp Stars and Stripes from Pompano Beach, Florida. This year, Goodyear is celebrating its 100-year anniversary. The 72nd consecutive year for its blimp operation. We welcome you back inside. And Tom Gordon takes over. Well, we talked about the importance of an ace in a starting rotation, and Pedro Martinez, Jimmy Williams not electing to go to Pedro Martinez today, hoping that they would get to game five and using him tomorrow night in Cleveland. Well, he is not playing around with his 1-0 game in the eighth inning, going to his closer, Gordon, who faces the pinch hitter, Cora, strike one.
You do not see too many closers going two innings, but Tom Gordon is well rested. He did not work yesterday. He has had 2 days off, Thursday and yesterday.
He pitched in game two, allowed one run in one inning. And you look at the regular season for Gordon, which was incredible. 46 saves and a major league record, 43 consecutive saves.
Pretty good combination, a hard high fastball and a good curveball.
Cora pops it into left field. Back to get it. O'Leary puts it away. One down. So the leadoff man is gone here in the eighth inning, and this copyrighted telecast is presented by authority of the Commissioner of Baseball. It may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form, and the accounts and descriptions of this game may not be disseminated without expressed written consent. One out, back to the top of the order, and Kenny Lofton, who's 0 for 3.
Huge numbers against Tom Gordon for Lofton.
Lofton shatters his bat and drops a base hit into center field. So Kenny is 1 out of 4, and there's the tying run Lofton on here in the eighth inning, with Vizcal and Justice coming up.
Now the battle becomes as compelling, Gordon and Lofton, as Gordon and Vizcal. Saws him off. The head of the bat goes one way. Lofton hanging on to the handle, and the ball dropping in front of Darren Lewis. Vizcal, a base stealer by design, will take a pitch or two to give Lofton a chance to run, one would assume.
Lofton stole 54 bases in the regular season, was caught 10 times, and he is 1 for 1 in this division series. A fastball for a strike to this go.
Gordon quick pitched Lofton then. Kenny did not have a chance to get a good jump at first base.
The tying run, Lofton at first with one out here in the eighth. Into right field, that's a base hit for Vizcal. Back-to-back singles for Lofton and Vizcal here in the eighth inning with the Indians down by one. Red Sox fans probably thinking, wouldn't you know it? They get the start from Schourek, 5 1/3 innings, shutout baseball and only two hits.
Derek Lowe, an inning and two-thirds. He was perfect, striking out two. And then the guy who's been most automatic this season, Tom Gordon, comes in and gives up back-to-back hits after one was out. So Lofton and Vizquel with Justice digging in. A strike from Gordon. We look back, game two. David Justice in the second inning, this shot with a couple on, two out, a three-run blast to help the Indians win game two back in Cleveland. Lofton is stealing third, and no throw by Hatteberg. The tying run is 90 feet away with one out.
It is interesting to watch a base stealer like Lofton when he's on second base. He walks into the line to stay mobile. He doesn't walk away from the base. Watch him walk into the line. Bang, he's gone. No throw.
Now first and third with one out, and Justice into deep right center field. In to score is Lofton. Digging for third, and now digging for home is Vizquel. A two-run double by Justice. It's 2-1 Cleveland in the eighth. And Fenway Park is dead quiet. Except for the Indian dugout, as Cleveland has overtaken the Red Sox here in the eighth inning.
A fastball to Lofton, and then to Vizquel, and now to Justice. Once again, Justice has a chance to extend those long arms, and it doubles to the deepest part of the ballpark, allowing Vizquel to score also. And for the first time in this game, behind David Justice, his second double in a row, the Indians take the lead.
Still only one out, and Justice is at second for Manny Ramirez, who hits it hard, but right at Valentin. He's throwing cross in plenty of time, two out. Gordon has fooled nobody.
He has not thrown his curveball in this inning. All fastballs by Tom Gordon.
So Gordon, who gave up a run in one inning in game two,
number 17, the third baseman,
has given up three consecutive hits, including a two-run double by Justice. And Gordon has given up the lead. It's 2-1 Cleveland in the eighth, with Travis Fryman at the plate, Justice at second, and two out. Fryman takes a ball. We haven't seen the curveball yet.
No. To our knowledge, there is nothing wrong with Tom's elbow that would prevent him throwing the curveball, but he has not featured the curveball in this inning.
Two balls, no strikes on Fryman. And I'll say it again. The Red Sox get five and a third shutout innings from Pete Schourek. The game in which most here in Boston thought Pedro Martinez should throw. Derek Lowe, an inning and two-thirds, perfect with two strikeouts. And Tom Gordon, who had one blown save in the regular season, has given up the lead here in the eighth inning. Fryman takes low, and the count goes to 3-0.
How about that? It's almost 6 months since Flash Gordon gave up a save and blew a save. Wow.
Fryman waits for a 3-0 pitch. Will he cut it loose? Time called at the plate by Tim Sheeta, the home plate umpire. That's low for ball four, and after Cora lined out to left field, we've seen a single, a two-run double, the smash to third by Manny Ramirez for the second out, and now a walk handed out by Gordon to Travis Fryman.
That's a good point, Joe, because even the two outs in this inning have been hit hard.
The line drive by Cora and the rope by Ramirez. Joe Kerrigan out to talk to one of the major's best relievers, Tom Gordon. What a job this guy did this year.
Number 25.
The biggest hit of this inning is off the bat of David Justice. He never blinked going down to first. He didn't want to miss. That ball bouncing up against the wall in deep right center. And it's now 2-1. The Indians lead as Tomey takes a ball in the dirt. That was the first breaking ball that we have seen from Flash Gordon. And that's his career against Tom. But these Indians with some pretty hefty averages against the Red Sox closer. Two on, two out, two runs in for Cleveland. One ball, one strike. Runners on first and second with two out. Tomey trying to add to the lead. Up on the count, 2-1. The Red Sox will have Valentin, Vaughn, and Garcia Parra to the plate in the bottom of this eighth inning. Tomey takes ball 3-1. Great shot of that couple from excited to pensive, and that kind of defines the crowd here at Fenway right now. Tom Gordon trying to end a long top of the eighth inning. Only two runs in for Cleveland as Tomey chased one 3-2. Tomey ready to unload, and Gordon got it faster. Tomey rips one to the second baseman Benjamin. Three loud outs, two big runs driven in by David Justice. Part of the order coming up, bottom of the eighth, 2-1 Cleveland.
Welcome, Dave.
Been a long time.
Sure has, Red.
You got a spicy chicken sandwich, but here, try this.
Not bad.
Water.
No, thanks. Ooh. Now try Wendy's spicy chicken.
Wendy's spicy chicken sandwich is a whole breast filet seasoned with Dave's own blend of pepper and spices. It's one very delicious, very spicy sandwich.
Please.
Try Wendy's spicy chicken sandwich and long live the king.
People worldwide.
So the bunny never stopped with the old battery, but we're giving him a new advanced one that'll let him go even longer.
Messes with your head, don't it?
Lever 2000, a tough deodorant clean, plus moisturizers for your skin, the touchable clean for all your 2000 parts.
Hey, beer man!
I'm the fastest beer man in Texas. That fan is thirsting for a cold frost brew Coors Light, and I'm the guy that's gonna give it to him, punk.
This game has passed you by, old-timer. I'll give this fan a cup of ice-cold Rocky Mountain refreshment faster than you can blink.
All right, two beers.
You still got it, old man.
Not bad yourself, kid.
The American League Division Series on Fox is brought to you by Gateway. Let's talk about your Gateway. And by Meineke Discount Mufflers. At Meineke, you won't pay a lot, but you'll get a lot.
Welcome back to Fenway Park. Steve Reed, the right-hander, goes back to work. He came on to retire Lewis with a runner at second and two out of the seventh. He got Lewis on a pop-up. And now we'll work to Valentin to start the eighth inning. And a strike from the side-arming right-hander Reed to Valentin, who's two for two plus a walk.
You may see three different Cleveland pitchers in this inning. Steve Reed, the right-hander, starting. Otzenmacher to pitch to Bo Vaughn, and Shuey brought in to pitch to Garciaparra.
Valentin out in front, strike two.
What about the two innings that David Justice had? Two great throws, one to almost get Valentin, one to get Valentin. So his arm did it in the sixth, his arms did it in the seventh.
There's no MVP in this round.
No.
But he would get the votes.
Absolutely.
Nothing and two, the count on Valentin. One away as Reed strikes out Valentin to start the eighth inning. Right now, let's return to Chip Carey in the Fox Television Center for an update.
Okay, Joe, thank you very much. The news out of New York apparently is very good on Daryl Strawberry. A very significant three-hour surgery today. A 16-inch portion of Daryl's large intestine was taken out. The cancerous tumor was removed. Apparently, the doctors say the cancer did not spread. Daryl is resting comfortably at Columbia Presbyterian Hospital in New York City. He'll stay there about a week, and everyone around the world of baseball breathing a big sigh of relief, and hopefully it'll be a full and complete recovery for Daryl Strawberry. Back to you in Boston.
All right, Chip, thank you very much. That's great news.
Great,
great news for Daryl Strawberry. And we have a moment to continue talking about this as Paul Otzenmacher will make his way in to face Mo Vaughn. And then, as you said, likely another pitching change after Otzenmacher deals with Vaughn, with Garciaparra, the cleanup hitter, after Mo, and Shuey still getting ready out in the Cleveland bullpen. But another word or two about Daryl Strawberry. You had a chance to know Daryl Strawberry at a very young age when he first came up with the New York Mets. He's made some mistakes along the way. He's recovered from those mistakes. And to a man, people you talk to in this game of baseball appreciate what Daryl Strawberry has been able to overcome and root for a man who is one of the nicest men you'll meet in the game today.
Coming up in 1983, and his woes have been chronicled, and you often see the team for whom a player played wearing perhaps his number, but rarely will you see teams in the league, other teams in the league, wearing number 39, as is the case tonight with Cologne, see Mo Vaughn, and others with Daryl Strawberry on their minds.
Paul Otzenmacher, Tim, takes over here in the eighth inning, and as you said, likely a one-batter effort for Otzenmacher, and it will be a big one as Mo Vaughn will step in, and what fans around here might look at is possibly his last at-bat here at Fenway in a Red Sox uniform.
Talking to Dan Duquette, the general manager of the Red Sox, before the game, he and Mo's representatives have put things on hold until after the season. Obviously a reasonable thing to do, particularly with the playoffs. The last offer made was in the four-year range for right around $36 million, about $9 million a year. Mo feels that he could possibly go out on the market, get more money, and if that's the case, he'll do that.
And as we talked about, another line that could be added to that graphic as you look at what he's done in 8 years here with the Red Sox, fan favorite. And Mo Vaughn will bat here in the eighth inning. There's a look at Dan Duquette under heavy fire when Clemens walked away, and you wonder what the future is with Mo Vaughn here in Boston. He walks in, and this crowd knows exactly what this at bat might signify as most of this crowd gets to his feet with one out, nobody on here in the eighth. Two to one Cleveland in the eighth inning. An
a ball from Ossenmacher.
The thing about Paul Ossenmacher is he has to be, in order to be effective, he has to stay away. And Vaughn with tremendous power the other way. I wouldn't look for Vaughn to be pulling the ball right here, but a natural stroke toward the wall.
A strike over the inside corner. The hands went up by Vaughn and called a strike, 1-1. Front there and now set up at 1-2. Mo is 0-for-3 in tonight's game. He's made three dazzling defensive plays. But Ossenmacher trying to shut him down at the plate for the fourth time tonight. 2-2.
Richie Sexton guarding the line at first base. Travis Fryman way off the line at third. I would be very surprised to see Mo Vaughn pull a ball down the first base line. I guess in this situation, you just have to protect against the oddity, and that would be a ball hit down the first base line.
Here it is on 2-2. Vaughn into left field. Back at the track, at the wall, off the top of the wall. And Vaughn will dig for second and make it with a one-out double. Ossenmacher comes in to try to retire Mo Vaughn. And Vaughn leaves to a standing ovation as he is lifted for a pinch hitter. If that's his last at bat in a Boston Red Sox uniform, it was big.
Look, they make olive oil.
Take a picture here.
All right.
Bonjour.
Oh, hi. How are you? Is this your business?
Yes.
Oh, we have our own business, too.
Yes, yes. We have three stores in Ohio.
Ohio. We send it to Ohio. And California and Canada and Argentina and Australia.
They're on the internet. How can they afford it?
Television's newest hero.
You saved my life.
Maybe I'm not the bad guy you think I am.
Is coming straight from hell.
Think you're going to heaven and you wake up someplace else.
Peter Horton.
Time to give the devil his due.
Brimstone, premiering October 27th on Fox.
Well, tonight at 7:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, the Atlanta Braves visit the Chicago Cubs. Braves lead that series 2-0. They could close out Chicago tonight. The Astros at the Padres, game 3. ESPN, 11 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. That's tonight. Well, Mo Vaughn with that signature uppercut swing and this off the wall and left.
A sequence, the second pitch of fastball inside. And then the breaking ball away, and Ossenmacher misses. And the double off the wall in left field. Those five pitches, people may be talking about that in 10 years when Mo Vaughn's been gone for 10 years. Who knows?
Paul Shuey now with Garcia Parra at the plate. Donnie Sandler takes over at second base, running for Mo Vaughn, and he carries the tying run with him. Who better for the Red Sox to have at the plate right now than Nomar Garcia Parra? No one. from the outside corner from Paul Shuey. Tying run at second, one out, and that's off the plate. Tough play for Freiman. Good play by Freiman, two out. Must have seemed like an eternity for that ball to come down for Travis Freiman, bounced off the plate. Garcia Parra, who can run, taken care of by the veteran Travis Freiman.
Travis Freiman made the best play in this series to perhaps save the game yesterday. In the fourth inning, runners on at first and third, a backhanded play on Garcia Parra's ball that held the Red Sox to one run, and here he comes in to nail Garcia Parra. But that play yesterday was a huge defensive play for Travis Freiman.
Now Mike Stanley. Breaking ball is low. Well, Mo Vaughn has given the Red Sox the chance with a one-out double. Sandler's running for him. Garcia Parra, the bouncer to third, and now it's Mike Stanley with a tying run at third, two out. 2-0 with O'Leary next. Sox need a two-out hit. Three balls and a strike from Shuey. One of the two hits in five career at-bats against Shuey for Stanley, a home run. Full count. To extend the inning for Troy O'Leary.
Last year, the Cleveland Indians were four outs away from elimination, and Sandy Alomar hit a home run off Mariano Rivera. The Red Sox are hoping for something similar in 98.
Stanley is relieved for a pinch runner, Damon Buford. So good speed on for the Red Sox with Sandler at third, the tying run. Damon Buford to go ahead run at first, two out for Troy O'Leary.
And Alomar has just given the middle infielders the sign for what he will do in case Buford runs.
And a check on Damon Buford. Saw the numbers for O'Leary, just one out of 15 in this division series. We're in the eighth. 2-1 Cleveland. Ball one to O'Leary. O'Leary, a 270 hitter during the regular season with 23 home runs. Alomar keeps it at the plate, 2-0.
That was a very difficult play. Sandy Alomar, not realizing that ball was down, tried to backhand that ball and was fortunate to do that. You don't see many catchers come up with balls that they have to backhand in the dirt, almost through the trap door.
O'Leary pops it up behind second. Lofton comes on, and the Indians are three outs away from going back to the ALCS. Vaughn a double. He's finished for the night. Still 2-1 Cleveland.
Hey. Matt, got your email. Vancouver? Genius. Pass it on to Epps. He's running it through the Northwest.
Hey, Matt. Ideas are hitting the Northwest. I've got purchasing checking suppliers.
You want it up top. Client briefing. Your Vancouver idea.
Want to take your business to the next level?
Claritin. Talk to your doctor or pharmacist today. Find out whether Claritin is right for you. Claritin tablets. Claritin D 24-hour. Claritin Ready Tab. Claritin Serum. Talk to your doctor or pharmacist about Claritin. For a $5 rebate certificate and free information, call 1-800-CLARITIN.
John Graham, veteran stuntman. This is how he lives. This is what he drives. What else would he drive? Chevy S10, like a rock.
Deliver us from evil.
Time to give the devil a deal.
Peter Horton stars in Brimstone, premiering Tuesday, October 27th.
We move to the ninth inning in this game four. Cleveland leading 2-1 and leading the game 2-1. As the Indians bat against Tom Gordon. And Sexton takes a ball up and in. It'll be Sexton, Alomar, and Cora. Two and oh. Donnie Sadler stays in the game and plays second base. That moves Mike Benjamin over to first. Sandler was a pinch runner for Mo Vaughn. Stanley was also replaced, but he's the DH for Buford. So it's Benjamin at first, Sandler at second. Defensively for Boston, the 2-0 pitch from Gordon. 3-0. Gordon had a rocky eighth inning, to use a kind word, after getting Cora on a line drive to left. Three consecutive hits, including the two-run double by Justice, and a hard ground ball out, a walk, and a line drive out. Three balls, no strikes on Sexton. Right down the middle, 3-1. Jimmy Williams is a smart baseball man with good instincts. Took a lot of criticism for starting Pete Schourek in tonight's game. That worked. He brings in Derek Lowe. He was saving Pedro Martinez for tomorrow night. Still might get the chance to use him. But as Gordon walks the leadoff man here in the ninth inning, I'll ask you if you think Jimmy Williams will be questioned or second-guessed for bringing Gordon in to start the eighth inning.
Well, he might be second-guessed, but that's a second-guesser's delight. But, I mean, here's the best you got. He's the guy in the bullpen that saved 46 games. He hasn't blown a save since April 14th. He's been two or more innings a bunch of times this year. His last time on August the 11th, he's gone three innings several times. So, I mean, how can you question a guy who loses with his best? I mean, it's the best they have. They love this situation, but unfortunately, Gordon coughed up two runs in the eighth inning.
And now is given a leadoff walk here in the ninth with Alomar at the plate. An 0-1 count. Double play. Gordon trying to keep this a one-run game, and he's two out, nobody on here in the ninth inning. On Fox NFL Sunday, join Chris, Terry, Howie, and JB for the latest scoop from around the league right up till the weekend's big games. It all begins tomorrow at noon Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific, right here on Fox. The base is empty and two out. Joey Cora takes a strike over the outside corner.
It's Sunday on Fox, where we go from oval ball to round ball tomorrow night.
There will be a game on Fox. We just at this point don't know which game it will be. Two out, nobody on, and one ball, one strike on Cora. It will be at 7:30 Eastern time tomorrow night, and it could be Boston at Cleveland. It could be the Cubs-Atlanta series in Chicago, game four. Or it could be the series out in San Diego with Houston, the Padres. One and two now on Cora at the end of tonight's game. Tim and I will select the Chevy truck player of the game. Mike Jackson getting ready for the bottom of this ninth inning. Cora, a floater into center field. Darren Lewis over to get it. Gordon gets through the ninth inning. Got around a leadoff walk. The bottom of the order will bat for Boston in the ninth inning against Jackson.
Sean Graham, veteran stuntman. This is how he lives. This is what he drives. What else would he drive? Chevy S10, like a rock.
Thanks. Matt, got your email. Vancouver? Genius. Pass it on to Epps. He's running it through the Northwest.
Hey, Matt. Ideas are hitting the Northwest. I've got purchasing checking suppliers.
You want it up top. Client briefing. Your Vancouver idea.
Want to take your business to the next level?
This week's games are so intricate, we had to call in reinforcements.
Somehow Chris was able to talk Madden into writing with us.
And we went right to work analyzing the Eagles-Broncos matchup. Can the Eagles steal one in Denver, or will Terrell Davis and the Super Bowl champs notch a win in an interconference war?
John, we really appreciate your help, especially considering how you hate to fly.
Don't mention it.
Yeah, you're a real trooper.
It's a Fox NFL Sunday doubleheader tomorrow, noon Eastern, 9 Pacific.
We welcome you back for the bottom of the ninth inning here in Boston. Fenway Park, we present to you our Dr. Pepper play of the game. David Justice with that drive into right center field in the eighth inning, scoring two runs. Lofton and Vizquel to put Cleveland out in front, 2-1. The only other run of the night, a leadoff home run by Nomar Garciaparra in the fourth inning for Boston. That's it. A game dominated by pitching, including Boston starter Pete Schourek. And a great effort tonight, Tim, from this Cleveland bullpen. And the latest to come out of that bullpen is Mike Jackson.
And Mike Hargrove has worked this bullpen in masterly fashion tonight. He's used five pitchers for the last six hitters for Boston.
Atterberg, the number seven hitter, leads it off and takes a pitch up and in. 2-1, Cleveland leads. If they win, they'll face the Yankees in the 1998 ALCS. If they lose, the series goes back to Cleveland. Off the bat of Hanneberg to the second baseman. Terrible throw, but dug out and saved by Sexton. One away.
Mike Hargrove telling us before the game that Richie Sexton is not a great first baseman yet, but he has the hands and the range to be a good one. And he proves it with his hands right here.
One down, and Cora bailed out by Sexton, the rookie. And we will have a pinch hitter here in the ninth inning for Mike Benjamin. Midri Cummings will come off the bench and bat for Jimmy Williams. Mike Jackson has two saves in this series. He did allow a home run, a two-run shot in the ninth inning, which made it a one-run game here yesterday afternoon and evening. But for the season, Mike Jackson, his first full year as the full-time closer, saved 40 of 45. Here's Cummings.
Jackson picking up for Jose Mesa when Mesa had all those problems last year, and then picking up for Jose Mesa after he was traded this year. Mike Jackson has just done a terrific job. He can either be a great setup man or a great closer, as he's proven this year.
Medry Cummings hit two pinch hit home runs during the regular season and was a good man off the bench for Jimmy Williams. One out, nobody on, one ball, no strikes. High 2-0. Whatever works as Boston tries to get a game five in Cleveland. 2-1 from Mike Jackson. Garcia Parra trying to get this crowd going here in the ninth inning. Three and one. Off the end of the bat to the shortstop, Vizquel gets an easy hop and throws out Cummings. And the Indians are one out away from the 1998 ALCS. And the Red Sox are one out away from hearing about the curse of the Bambino again. Here's the turning point, without a doubt. With a couple on and one out, this shot by David Justice, the two-run double. That's the run production for the Indians tonight, and it might just be enough.
Two turning points. Justice's defense and then his offense.
Darren Bragg now with two out, nobody on. The last hope for the Red Sox in the ninth. A strike over the inside corner. Darren Bragg tonight, 0 for 3. One ball, one strike. The Cleveland Indians trying to get into the American League Championship Series for the third time in the last 4 years, including 1998. Mike Jackson wants a new baseball. One ball, one strike on Bragg, trying to get this ninth inning back to the top of the order. The only portion of this Red Sox batting order that's done any damage almost this entire series. The 1-1, strike two, and the Indians are one strike away from advancing to the next round. Game over, series over. The Indians are going back to the ALCS. A perfect 1-2-3 ninth inning for Mike Jackson. What a game for David Justice. And what a well-managed game this was for Mike Hargrove. Justice with the offense, a pair of doubles, the two-run double in the eighth inning to put the Indians on top for good. David Justice is tonight's Chevy Truck Player of the Game. And Mike Hargrove ought to smile. A combination of Cologne, Poole, Reed, Ossenmacher, Shuey, and Jackson shut down the Red Sox. Garcia Parra, the only Boston Red Sox player right now out in front of the dugout, applauding the fans for their support in 1998.
Well, that's great right there. That's super.
Schourek Joining us on our telecast tonight is Bob Halloran, who has a guest for us. Bob.
All right, Dave Dustin, you've had a lot of big hits in your career. Was today's the biggest?
No, today wasn't the biggest. The one I hit in 95 World Series to win it, that was the biggest. But this is a great game for us. I mean, Boston keeps coming. Sure, it came out to a great game against us, but I told all the guys we got to play hard for nine innings. And we stayed close, and we were able to win.
This series started so poorly for you, 11-3 at home. You're able to bounce back. Is that confidence, experience, or both?
Well, it's just like any series. I mean, I never anticipate sweeping any team. So you know you're going to lose one game. Well, that first game, we felt like about one game. Now let's go and try to win first 1-3.
What about balancing at the plate? Were you surprised to see him going, and did you feel like you had him?
I wasn't surprised because that's the way they play. I mean, very aggressive ball club. And, you know, you can't fault Wendell Kim. If I throw the ball offline, you know, he's safe. So I felt confident when I got the ball. If I just relax and throw it, I'm going to get him.
All right, thanks very much, Dave Dustin. Appreciate it, and we'll throw it back upstairs to Joe and Tim.
All right, Bob Halloran, thank you very much. Well, Nomar Garciaparra was the only Red Sox player out in front of the Boston dugout applauding the fans for their support in 1998. And Tim McCarver, the Cleveland Indians just keep getting back there. This is a very solid, very deep, very talented team under Mike Hargrove.
They came from behind to beat the Yankees in the divisional playoffs last year, and they came from ahead to beat the Red Sox this year.
You also have to wonder here in Boston if we saw the final game for Mo Vaughn,
yep,
in a Boston Red Sox uniform. That's what folks around here will turn their attention toward as the Indians turn their attention toward the New York Yankees and the 1998 American League Championship Series. So for Tim McCarver, I'm Joe Buck. So long from Fenway Park in Boston. The final score, 2-1. The Indians win it. They win the series 3-1. Chip Carey and Steve Lyons will be along with more Division Series highlights after these words. Good night from Boston.